guys! Well, it has been a while, and I don't know about you, but I feel busier than I've ever felt before. It seems like there's always something to do. Between the kids' many, many Zoom calls for everything from school to their after-school activities that are all being done on the Zoom calls, it just feels like we always have something going on. So I haven't been able to spend as much time as I wanted to pondering the things that I'm gonna share with you today. And life's probably gonna get even busier now that it's spring and it's time to go out in the yard and plant the garden. So I don't know that that's ever gonna end, but I'll do my best to share with you the thoughts that I've had since the last video message. So I wanna give you an outline for today's video so you can kinda get a feel for what I'm gonna start with, where I'm going, and where I'm gonna end. I'm gonna start by talking about current events, world news, national news, and even some news right here in Utah. Then I'm gonna share with you some aha moments that some of my friends have been having and sharing with me, all related to the coronavirus, the Passover, the worldwide fast that we did. Then I'm gonna talk to you about some modern day Sharams. And if you don't know who Sharam is, he's a guy that we recently studied in Come Follow Me. In the book of Jacob, he denies Jesus Christ and some bad things happen to him. So I've been noticing again some modern day Sharams popping up and wanted to talk about that again, as well as some thoughts that I've been having about that and noticing with everything that's been happening right now during these last days. Then I wanna share with you the highlights of what I heard the Lord say at General Conference. And then I'm going to end it with a dream that I had and how that relates to some of the things I'll mention throughout the video. So, I hope it's not all over the place today. All right, but before I get started, I just wanted to share with you some of my favorite things this week. First of all, for those of you who follow my Happy Lady Facebook page, you probably already saw me post about some awesome music that I discovered for my kids. It's Christian music that actually sounds good and appeals to teens. And what I love appeals to teens. So I shared all the details of that in my post about how I wanted to find other sounds of Christian music because a lot of the music just always sounds the same. It's repetitive. A lot of the songs get overplayed and my kids get tired of hearing it. So I was looking for some different sounds in the Christian genre and I think I hit the jackpot. So I'll have a link to that post down below. It'll link you right to my Facebook post. But I wanted to share that if you also have been looking for some great music that sounds modern, that appeals to teens. It's my style of music too, so I love it. And isn't overplayed or even played at all on the radio stations. So check it out. I hope you like it. Also, my sister wanted me to put a plug in for that TV series on VidAngel called The Chosen. A lot of you have seen it and you're already fans of the show. We finally got around to watching it this weekend. We've only seen the first episode, but I hear it gets better and better and better. But from what I've seen, I'm a fan too. So she said, when you do your next video, you have to put in a plug for that show. It is so good. So this was for the 28th Annual Movie Guide Awards, which aired February 24th on the Hallmark Drama Channel. And it says the Chosen star Jonathan Rumi took home the Grace Award for his TV performance, which he plays the role of Jesus. So when my husband saw him on that first episode, he said, oh, I don't know if I can get into this. He doesn't look like how I imagine Jesus. He doesn't look like the typical Jesus that you see portrayed in Bible movies. And I said, oh, just give him a chance. And so my sister said, no, he's amazing. And then when I heard that he won this award, I thought, hey, I'm excited. So I just wanted to put that out there for those of you who have not seen it yet or who haven't even heard of it. Go ahead and check it out. All right, so I get a lot of stuff sent to me all the time, which is a good thing because it helps me stay up to date on current events. I don't always have a lot of time to be reading the headlines, and so I love it when you guys send me videos and news articles and things that I wouldn't otherwise see or know about. And there are times when certain videos or news articles get sent to me continuously, and usually that's when it's a really big story or something really shocking and people want me to know, are you aware of this? Have you heard of this? What are your thoughts about it? And so sometimes the same stories and videos will get sent to me by a lot of different people. And that was the case this week for a couple of stories that I hadn't heard about, so I was grateful that the videos were sent to me. And I'll have links to all of this down below. But the first one was about an act called the New Way Forward Act, which the Democrats, I believe, have introduced to the House, but nothing's happened since January. So I checked an update on this and it doesn't seem like there's been any progress as of yet. But the whole purpose of this bill is to remove all the limits for immigration and allow anybody and everybody to immigrate into the US. And it even goes so far as to say that if you've been deported from the United States because you came here illegally and you murdered people while you were here, that doesn't matter, you get to come back. This is your home, and we're sorry we kicked you out of your home. The bill talks about ignoring all past criminal history, that all becomes void. You get a fresh start here in this country, even if you were a drug lord or a part of the drug cartel or involved in human trafficking, it doesn't matter. You get a driver's license, you get health insurance. The American taxpayers will spend about $1 billion buying all of these people plane tickets to fly them back into America. And it was just interesting to think that crimes that if you and I committed, we would be arrested, we would be sent to prison, but these illegal immigrants who came here and committed these crimes, they get a free pass, an invitation and a warm welcome back into the United States. And as I thought about it, I thought, well, I'm sure this is another way to influence the elections, because if you have all these immigrants pouring into the US, who are here because of a bill that the Democrats passed, who are here because of the Democrats, they'll be allowed to vote, and they're going to vote Democrat. So it's a way for the Democratic Party to bring in a huge amount of immigrants who are all going to vote Democrat. It seems that that's the purpose behind this, at least from what I think. So later that day, I was talking to my mom about this on the phone, and she said, well, don't you think that President Trump will do some kind of executive order or something to put a stop to this? And it was so crazy because later that day, I got this tweet from President Trump that says, I will be signing an executive order to temporarily suspend immigration into the United States. And even though he uses coronavirus as the reason for making this decision, you know, it's a way to protect America, it almost seems like he's playing hardball with the Democrats. He's sort of beating them at their own game. He's one step ahead of them, but he's able to do so in the name of coronavirus. So it's just kind of interesting to see this happening in real time. My mom had just made that comment, and then just a few hours later, I see this tweet. It's just crazy how this is all happening. Now, I sent a link to this video to my friend Karen, and she sent me back this screenshot. Take a look at these numbers she saw when she clicked on this video. Right there, you have 113 and 111. And look at what time it was when I opened up this text. It was 1:44 p.m. Of course it was. For those of you who follow my channel, you know how I see these certain numbers all the time. And I've shared time and time again what they mean to me, what they represent. This is incredible, where so many of them are showing up right here in this one screenshot. Just tells me, pay attention to this. This is a news story you don't want to forget about. Then I heard about a bill that's trying to be passed in Utah right now called House Bill 3009, which basically takes away the Fourth Amendment. It allows the government to seize your property or house arrest you on your own property. So here's what the bill says. It says that it requires an order of constraint to expire within 14 days. It allows a civil penalty of $1,000 to be imposed on a person who has tested positive for a pandemic disease, who has been directly ordered by the health department to stay at home for quarantine purposes, and who violates that order. So it's crazy because it is going against our constitutional rights, but it's in the name of safety. So this reminds me of what happened during World War II. Just little by little, they took away rights and freedoms in the name of safety, in the name of the goodness for all, for the better of the community, for the better of the country, for the good of everyone. So people went along with that and said, yes, this is for the good of everybody. We should do this. We should allow this. We should support this. But when this happens, our freedoms and our rights are taken away from us under the disguise of safety and the good of everyone. I've just never seen this happen in my life before. So this comes from defendingutah.org, which I have a link to their video down below. But they report late Wednesday night, Defending Utah went live with an emergency notice of surprise legislation being rushed through Utah's legislature. I saw that video, I have a link to it down below. Together, our swift actions have succeeded in stalling the vote on this atrocious legislation for the moment. The counterclaims to Defending Utah's position have been along these lines. This is better local control. We're limiting power, not expanding it. And we're just transferring the power from one place to another. It's already there. Defending Utah's position is that this counter rhetoric is untrue and misleading. Those who want to steal our liberties are covering their tracks and making excuses. Here's an analysis by Dr. Scott Bradley. He says, "It appears that the bill has not been killed, but they are attempting to salvage their efforts with making some superficial changes that will not diminish the tyranny they are implementing." Another analysis says, "You may have heard that HB 3009 alters a few simple, harmless, and particular points of the law. Don't be deceived. This has the power to put our communities into a continued state of fear and quasi-martial law. It says due process and constitutional rights do not hold under HB 3009. It allows cities direct access to federal and outside private aid along with the strings that come with that aid. So if your city wants to get help from an outside private organization or entity, you can do so at their mercy. You become attached to their strings and you become their puppet. So they're saying it erodes state authority and sovereignty, and it does not bind politicians down to protecting life and liberty. It allows chief executives of cities to isolate, quarantine, and imprison American citizens. It authorizes this without due process, so you don't get a trial. It exercises control over individuals. It allows them to close businesses, schools, public places, and to restrict constitutional rights of assembly and protest. So not only can they shut anything down anytime they want, but you can't assemble together and protest against this. Well, that's what America is. I believe that denying Americans their basic constitutional rights, especially the right to protest, the right to freedom of speech, denying them these basic rights is what could lead to a civil war here in America. And as you can see, the mainstream media is reporting this as a conservative issue. It's just the people on the right who want to protest. It's just the people on the right who want to speak out against this. But we know that's not true. That is the way that they are painting it right now. We know that in a lot of states right now, here in America, there are people who are very unhappy with their governors and how they are handling this coronavirus situation. And so they are protesting at their state capitals. And when you have a lot of people that are upset with their local government, well, that can lead to more unrest. There's a lot of news that in certain states, certain governors are treating this like World War II Nazi Germany. They're taking away a lot of rights of their people, and it's becoming a dictatorship, which should never happen in a state.
Anyways, I have links to all of this down below if you want to click on it and read more, but this is pretty scary. This is not the America that I grew up in. This sounds very much like Nazi Germany. I thought it was interesting that in the video that I shared down below where I first heard about this, they kept bringing up the number 14, 14 days, 14 days, 14 days. And in the other video that talks about the New Way Forward Act, it was interesting to learn in that video that there are 44 Democrats who support that act and that it contains 4,400 words. There's the number 44. I see it all the time. I talked about it in the last video because I've been seeing it everywhere and I thought maybe it's telling me to pay attention to April 4th, which was conference. But then again, maybe it's pointing me to be aware of this act that is designed to strip away our freedoms and put our nation in danger. It's just all my pay attention numbers. A lot of you have reached out to me and have told me that you see the number 14 all the time. And we've had lots of conversations about 14 and that connection with Jewish holy days, traditions, and the first 14 years of the history of the church. And Joseph Smith was 14 years old when he had the first vision, and just so many other places that you've been seeing that number and have been studying it and pondering it. So I heard it in the video about the Utah House Bill 3009, and then I heard the number 44 repeatedly in the video by Fox News about the New Way Forward Act. So those are pay attention numbers. Just wanted to share so that you could be aware of them as well, because I was not. And I think that's the way this has been planned. It hasn't been reported in the media and no one's talking about it, so that they can just quickly and quietly slip it in. So something to be aware of. So in this video, I'm not going to get into all of the rumors that have been swirling about the truth about this virus, the truth about how it originated, where it came from, conspiring plans of the enemy, all of that, right? There's been so much that's been sent to me that clearly is alarming. There has been a lot that has been sent to me, lots of videos of doctors and medical professionals trying to blow the whistle on all of this. And there's been so much, I started to wonder the other day, what if this is a part of the plan? What if the enemy is actually putting out these videos saying that they are whistleblowing on the enemy? Just to stir up fear and more confusion and chaos. And then today, my husband told me that they just found out that China is the culprit of the rumor several weeks ago that the National Guard was going to roll into every city and state and enact martial law. I got so many emails about that and private messages and texts, even people in my family calling me saying, don't tell anybody this, I just found this out, I could lose my job. And you know, you saw those messages on Facebook. I heard this from a good buddy, a close friend of mine, someone who works in the government, and they've shared with me that this is about to happen. They're gonna shut everything down with the National Guard and roll in the tanks and enforce martial law, and it's gonna be a surprise to everyone, and it never happened. And so they're now saying that China started that rumor to create more fear and chaos here in America. So then it makes me wonder about all these other videos that I see. They're kind of similar, saying, I just found this out, I just discovered this, I'm trying to get the word out, or I'm blowing the whistle on this. So to sum all of this up, it's almost as though you don't know who to believe. You don't know who's telling the truth. You don't know the source behind any of it. I mean, aside from all of these videos and whistleblowers, it's clear to see that our freedoms are slipping away from us because of what's happening. And it's clear to see that a lot of things are being put in place and set up that are pretty shocking, that have never happened before in my lifetime, and that are very alarming, that could lead to more alarming things. So it doesn't take a rocket scientist to notice that, to pick up on that. So instead of talking about all of those rumors in this video, what I would like to suggest is we really get a handle on our fear, because there's so much swirling around out there, whether it's true or it's not true, it's causing a lot of fear among so many people. And that is the opposite of what we are to be as disciples of Christ. We're to show the world that we don't live by fear, we live by faith, because we have hope. The apostles and leaders of the church reminded us at this past conference that we have a bright, hopeful future on the horizon. Even if that's referring to the millennium, that's when everything will be bright and wonderful. Well, so be it. Let's look forward to that with a brightness of hope. But everything that happens between now and then, we have to keep our eyes on the Lord. Make Him our focus. Don't lose sight of Him, or we're going to get distracted by all of this other stuff, and it's going to bring us down into that place of fear, which gives the enemy power. We don't want to give him power. So we become powerful against the enemy when we stay in a place of faith and we call upon the power of our God every day. And here's the perfect example of what happens when we call on the power of our God. This is a graph
of the worldwide fast that President Nelson invited the whole world to participate in. And as you can see, the tallest bar where it starts to go down after that, that was from April 10th, the day that we began our fast. You can see right here the result of our faith, especially when it's united together. And another post says, on Sunday, April 19th, the president said this in his address about the coronavirus. I posted this on my wall right after and thought I'd share here too. Amazing. President Trump just said the coronavirus has decreased remarkably in the past 9 days. Guess what the world did 9 days ago? Yep, that was the fast that I just shared the results with you on the slide before. And speaking of President Nelson being inspired, remember in 2018 when the church announced the closing of several pageants? 2019 would be the last opportunity to see many of those pageants, as their closing would officiate in the year 2020. Now, in the last video message, I talked about how inspired our prophet is and how many of the changes that have come forth from the church have showed the result of that inspiration. We talked about that in that last video, and I went over a whole list of changes and how inspired they were. Here's another one that I forgot to add to the list. As you can see, this year, we are not having any pageants because of the coronavirus. There are to be no mass gatherings, and so even the pageants that would have remained open, time wouldn't have been wasted preparing for them because everything's been shut down throughout all of March, all of April, and most likely into May. There will be no time to put together a pageant even if things did open up this summer. And many people thought that this decision was sending a message that families really should be simplifying their lives and members of the church should be focusing more on their families and teaching their families at home the gospel. But now you just can't help but wonder if President Nelson knew more. He knew what was coming and he knew that we needed to close these pageants down so that we wouldn't waste our time preparing for something that wasn't going to happen. But isn't it interesting that he didn't close down all the pageants? Let's take a look at the list. So according to this list, all of the pageants in Utah and the pageant in New York were the only ones that were going to close. I remember when I first heard this news, I couldn't help but wonder, is something coming to Utah and New York? Something that would really prevent a pageant from happening or mass gatherings from happening. But I was thinking along the lines of persecution. I wasn't thinking pandemic. And maybe closing all the pageants at once would have caused more alarm and more speculation. So leaving some of the pageants open would allow for people to not spend a lot of time reading into this. We just talked about this in this week's Come Follow Me lesson from King Benjamin's address. We talked about how prophets are seers and revelators. And thank goodness we have that in our day.
And there's been a lot of talk about how confusing everything happening with the missionaries is right now. We've had the missionaries called home from foreign countries, and they're in a waiting period right now and, you know, deciding if they're going to re-enter the mission field again. But yet there are those who haven't gone out yet who have been getting their calls to foreign countries. People are saying a lot of this isn't making sense how this is to work. Is there going to be one more last harvest in the mission field where the missionaries go out one more time and give it their all? My sister pointed out something pretty interesting. She said, this almost seems like a separation of the wheat and the tares among the missionaries. The Lord needs the best of the best out there right now in this final harvest. So this is an opportunity for all those who aren't serious about it to say, you know what, I served a few months, I'm great, I'm gonna move on to other things now because this is an honorable release because of this virus. So this is my opportunity to exit through the door and do so honorably. But then those missionaries who are really burning with the Spirit and they're saying, no, I can't wait to get back out there. I need to get back out there. I wanna be out there doing the work. The Lord's going to send them out to complete that final harvest. So those were the thoughts of my sister, and I thought that was very interesting. I'd love to hear your thoughts about it as well. And we've been told that the temple closures and church closures are temporary, but as others have pointed out, it's very possible after they reopen, something like this happens again later this year or even next year, and we're right back in the same place. So even though we're told that closures are temporary, reopenings might be temporary as well. Something to think about, something to be prepared for.
Here is a quote from Heber C. Kimball, and this has been circulating around right now. I have verified it. I did go to the life of Heber C. Kimball, and I went to page 453, and this exact quote is there. So I have the link down to that below if you want to check it out. But he said, "The time would come when the government would stop the saints from holding meetings. When this was done, the Lord would pour out his judgments." Just something to think about right now during this time that we're living in. Now, there have been rumors all week circulating around the globe that the leader of North Korea is dead, or at least brain dead. And this article here said that there is a theory that coronavirus could have been the contributing factor to Kim's death because he had underlying conditions. He had obesity, high blood pressure, and diabetes. And the rumor is that he had heart issues. He had heart surgery, but it was not a success. These rumors have been swirling for quite a while now, and North Korea is saying that he is just fine, that he is simply just recovering from a health condition. But there hasn't been any concrete evidence to support those claims. So at this point, we really don't know the status of his health or if he is alive. We do know that his sister is next in line should he pass away. And so either way, clearly we can see there are changes happening in North Korea right now. And it would be really wise to keep them in our prayers because we know change is what allows doors to be opened in other nations for the gospel to be preached. Also, headlines over the last couple of weeks have been about China having a math problem with their coronavirus count. Also, with talk again that the coronavirus came out of the Wuhan lab. This, of course, has led to a lot of worldwide anger and rage towards China. We even have a state here in the U.S., the state of Missouri, who is suing China, which is something that I've never heard of before, a state suing another country. But they are suing China and wanting to hold them accountable for all of this. Right after the last video message I put out, almost within 24 hours, there were all these crazy similar stories. This first one was a Texas man accused of stabbing an Asian family over coronavirus. So we can see how the situation in China and the news coming out of China has created a lot of hate crimes. And of course, hate crimes, and crimes for that matter, are usually most always caused by fear. Here's another one within just 24 hours of this last news story. It says, "Nurse allegedly killed medic girlfriend, claimed she gave him coronavirus." So as you can see, there's so much confusion still surrounding this virus. People just don't understand it. And because of that confusion, there's a lot of fear. Because of the unknown, there's a lot of fear, a lot of unnecessary fear that's causing a lot of people to do things they wouldn't normally otherwise do. Here's another unfortunate story fresh from yesterday that says top Manhattan ER doctor commits suicide, shaken by coronavirus. She just couldn't handle all the cases coming into the hospital. It was too much stress, too overwhelming. She was too overworked, and she ended her life. I have some links down below that I think shed the most light on what's really going on here with these doctors and coronavirus and everything surrounding it. It's a 2-hour video, but it's well worth the listen if you have the time. So I have the link to that down below if you want to check it out. Now here's something strange I encountered last week while out on a walk. I was out on a walk with my daughter and our dog, and we came to this certain part of the walk where I noticed there were honeybees dead all over the sidewalk. This just continued on and on and on, and throughout the rest of our walk, we noticed honeybees everywhere that were dead on the sidewalks. I haven't seen anything quite like this before. I've heard about it, but I haven't seen it. So we were thinking about it all day. I came home and put it on Facebook and asked if anybody else in the neighborhood had noticed. And a neighbor a few doors down said that this very same day she was outside cleaning her windows and she saw giant swarms of thousands and thousands and thousands of bees flying over our street. She said it was so loud. The way she described it, I imagined the sound of a jet or a helicopter just flying over the neighborhood, and it really startled her. And then later that day, my husband found this local news story that confirms what my neighbor saw. It says, family finds more than 50,000 bees outside their Davis County home. This wasn't too far from where I live. And so this was really fascinating. It said in the article that the bees were simply just looking for a new home. Well, why are all these bees dying and why are they moving and trying to find a new home? So another friend of mine who lives in Idaho, she asked me if I had seen chemtrails that day over my house. And the crazy thing about it was, is I had. We were in the car that morning right after my walk. We were driving up the road with the family and I looked up at the sky and I noticed all the white chemtrail lines crisscrossing in the sky. And I was about to point it out to my kids when we got distracted with a song on the radio. Now the crazy thing is this is the second time this has happened recently right near where I live in Davis County. And according to this article, it said the family called in a beekeeper to help them out. The keeper said the trick was to getting the queen bee so that the others would follow. What's interesting, something that stood out to me in this article was it makes mention of a cherry tree. It said that the huge swarm of bees took over her cherry tree that just suddenly showed up Sunday afternoon. Because within just 24 hours, I had heard three separate stories about a cherry tree. I make mention of Cherry Tree Lane in this video when I talk about Mary Poppins and the family living on Cherry Tree Lane. And I've had other instances within our family that have related to a cherry tree. So cherry tree is sort of a pay attention word for me lately. If any of you have had any experiences with anything relating to cherry trees, I'd love to hear from you. But I'm not sure why I keep hearing that word so much within just the last couple of days.
Okay, so now I want to talk with you about these modern day sharums that are popping up again. So I actually made some notes in my phone about my thoughts about all of this. So I'm just going to go ahead and read these notes to you. I wrote, I've been seeing modern day sharums, people denying the gospel very vocally and publicly leaving it, and then coming down with major trials, misfortunes, tragedies, and illness almost instantly. Just like Sharam, he denied Christ, he asked for a sign, if he's real, prove it to me. And he got his sign and he collapsed and later died. So I've been noticing that happening with people, just different people on Facebook being very public and vocal about their disdain towards the church or towards the gospel. And the minute they do that, suddenly they come down with an illness or a major trial. I wrote, you might say that's a sign, but I see it as God removing his hand of protection. As these people break and deny their covenants and promises, God can no longer keep his promise to protect them from the power and influence of the destroyer, aka the destroying angel. Just like with the Passover. And then what I've noticed about these people is when they share on Facebook that now they've come down with an illness or some kind of major trial, instead of asking people for prayers, like, please pray for me, these people in their stubbornness and pride instead ask for good thoughts, good vibes, good energy, or the universe to be with them. Or they ask for someone to offer their energy work services to help them cope with this or to help them heal. And as I was pondering about this over the weekend, what stood out to me when I was watching the first episode of The Chosen, in there, Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee and a member of the Sanhedrin, he is summoned by the Roman army to cast devils out of a woman who happens to be Mary Magdalene. And he's hesitant to do it, he's not very happy about it, but he complies and he goes to Mary, having not known her, and you can clearly see that she's overcome with some kind of demonic influence. And he says, by the God of Abraham and the God of Jacob, or by the power of the God of Abraham, by the power of the God of Jacob, the God of creation. And he's using these titles to command the demons out of her. And after all of his efforts are fruitless, the demons say through her, you have no power over me. And he's astonished by this. And he goes home to his wife and he's thinking, why couldn't I cast them out? You know, surely I said the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob.
Why didn't they respond to him? Why? So he says, surely only God himself has the power to cast out these demons. And as I pondered on this, I wrote, the power lies in the name of Jesus Christ. I've done videos about that before. There is power in the name of Jesus. The power lies in him. It lies in his name, and it flows through us when we honor our covenants. And so I found it interesting that these people on Facebook, these modern day sherems, refuse to seek for help from Jesus, refuse to mention his name, refuse to mention God, and they're finding no peace, no healing, no relief from their suffering. So I continue on in my thoughts. These people say that they researched bad stuff about the church and received revelation that the church was not true and that they needed to leave. So they left and their life fell apart. Jesus is the breath of life. I believe they asked if this negative stuff they were reading about was true. As some had mentioned, they had a sick feeling in their stomach and pursued that sick feeling, looking for confirmation of it so they could justify leaving. They pursued this path having already made that decision in their hearts. And they were just looking for that justification. When you look for justification, you will find it, no matter which side you are trying to justify. If you look into it, looking for the good and the promises and the blessings and the miracles, you will find it, and you will receive that witness. However, if you focus on the negative, the errors, the mistakes, the sins of others, and look for confirmation and a witness of that, you will find it. Something else I've been pondering on lately quite a bit is what I love and what I've realized about the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the Book of Mormon. You see, the Old Testament was for the people of the past. It testified of a coming Messiah who hadn't come yet. So it was all the prophecies. The New Testament was for the people of the present day. The Messiah had come, and the New Testament is all about his ministry here on the earth. It's about him setting up his church. It's about what he came here to do. And it's also about prophecy and the signs of his return. Now, the Book of Mormon was not only written for the people of the Old Testament era and the New Testament era, but most importantly, it was written for the future. For our day right now, for you and me, the Book of Mormon entails everything that happened to Jesus after he ascended out of Jerusalem, after his resurrection. Not only did he set up and establish his church over on that side of the world, but he also came to the Western Hemisphere and he set up and established his church here. There was no internet, there was no way for his church over there to connect with the people living over here. But yet he wanted everyone to have a knowledge of his gospel and of who he is. So he came here as well, and he set up a church on this continent. He also called 12 apostles. But in the Book of Mormon, it goes into detail. He provides covenants and ordinances. We hear more from the mouth of Jesus Christ in the Book of Mormon than any other book. As much as I love the Old Testament and as much as I really love the New Testament, I love the Book of Mormon because of how much of his word is in there. It is just dense with his love and his counsel and his teachings and words directly from his mouth. I believe we learn more about the nature of who he is and his character in the Book of Mormon than any other book, hands down. So all three support each other. We need all three. We need the Old Testament to show us the prophecies of old. We need the New Testament to show that those prophecies were fulfilled. And then we need the Third Testament, or the Book of Mormon, to show us that his word doesn't stop. He doesn't stop speaking to his children, and there's more to come. So to sum it up, all three books are about that Abrahamic covenant. They all speak of the importance of that Abrahamic covenant that we are to all be partakers of. So I continue on with my thoughts. Lots of other churches today prophesy, but what I don't see is them receiving new revelation. Prophecy is neat and it's exciting to hear about, and especially to see it come to pass. But what does any of that matter if we aren't receiving new instruction for this day that we're living in? If God isn't always teaching us, and I wrote in my notes, there is always more to be learned
We never stop learning from the Lord. So I continue on with these modern day Sherems. And I wrote, they all seem to be saying the same thing. Me, me, me. And I've talked about this in past video messages. I'm doing what's best for me right now. I'm following my own path. Well, no, it's God's path we are to follow, not our own path. There is one clear path to the Lord. They say, I'm following my intuition. Well, no, we need to be following the Spirit. There are only two influencers that we have, the Spirit of the Lord and the adversary. I truly don't ever believe that for a minute we are just following our own thoughts and our own voice. I believe we are always being influenced. If we're not being influenced by the Spirit, we're being influenced by the adversary, most definitely. Everything good comes from the Lord. Everything negative comes from Satan. So it's a lie when we tell ourselves, I'm just following my own intuition. I'm tuning everybody else out right now and I'm just listening to me. After all, it's my happiness, my life. Well, the truth is, we find our happiness when we consecrate our life to the Lord. When we sacrifice the things of this world, when we make sacrifices in our life for the Lord, that's when we find happiness. Sacrifice is essential to the Lord's plan. And Jesus Christ is the ultimate example of that. We are to be like him. We are not here for us, for our own pleasure. If so, if that's what we believe, we're wasting our time. We're wasting the Lord's time. We are here on a mission for the Lord. We are to always be on the Lord's errand. The me, me, me mentality is a false philosophy of the natural man. They say it's the philosophy of men, but I believe it's the philosophy of Satan. The natural man is simply giving in to Satan. And I've noticed that these modern day Sherems aren't out there serving others and sacrificing. They are self-centered, always focusing on themselves and what they need and what they want. And all of this abundance from the universe and bringing in their dreams and their goals, having that increase, all about them. And many times I've noticed that they are victims. I've been seeing patterns of poor me, help me, notice me, send positive vibes to me, etc., etc. But you see, the difference is the Lord's people say, is there anyone I can help today? No strings attached. And I've noticed that people respond to these modern day Sherems by saying, you go, girl, you do you. Glad you are putting yourself first. No, we are to put God first. The very first commandment, I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. We know the scripture, love the Lord thy God with all thy might, mind, and soul. We are taught to love God more than we love ourselves. We are taught to put him first in all things. That's when we find true happiness. And there was something that Elder Christofferson said in this last general conference that stood out to me because it relates to this. He said, our invitations cannot be a matter of self-interest. Rather, they must be an expression of selfless love. There's a big difference. So these modern day Sherems have their own self-interests. And the disciples of Christ have a selfless love. They're not thinking of themselves. They're loving their neighbors as they love themselves. They're always keeping their eyes open, looking for who they can help, who they can uplift. No strings attached, no hidden agendas. So I continue in my thoughts. People get so caught up in their path and seeking mysteries, as well as having their own supernatural experiences, that they have forgotten why we are here. We are to teach others his gospel. The gospel is simple, and we're to teach this to the whole world. That's when we find happiness. We're not to focus on a private group with minimal members and spend all of our time teaching those people hidden mysteries and knowledge. I see a lot of people still doing that. Why would the Lord want us to take all of our time, energy, and efforts and direct that towards a small private group with a small amount of members and just teaching them these secret mysteries and secret knowledge that we've discovered? That's not why we're here. We're here to share the simple truths, the simple gospel to the whole world on both sides of the veil. These people who are focusing on these small groups and the secret hidden knowledge and mysteries have missed the whole point.
And a lot of you have been reaching out to me lately, sharing with me your encounters and experiences with these people. And there's a lot of similarities. These people are quick to be offended, they're quick to condemn, and their focus isn't on service, it's on themselves and their knowledge. And as I continued in my thoughts, I noted that every time someone gets disfellowshipped from the church, there's a lot of hype at first surrounding that person all over social media. And then all of these groups sort of start to die down and you don't hear from them as much. And then suddenly it picks back up again. It's just like this reoccurring pattern. When someone gets disfellowshipped, another one pops up to replace them. And then the pattern continues. And then another person moves along to replace them. And then the pattern continues. And each time that happens, they continue to pull people off the path with them. Well, right now, I see this picking up again. And I know I've talked about this in so many videos in the past. I've talked about this so many times. But one of the main keywords that stands out to me that these patterns all seem to show is there's a certain topic that really gravitates these people. And when this topic comes up, it's like flies to honey. They just all start coming out. Everyone wants to talk about this. And as they do, people start sharing these new groups and people say, add me to your new group, please. I want to hear more. I want to learn more. And then that person starts to build a group and a following. And then the pattern repeats, the pattern continues. But the common focus, the common theme, the common topic that seems to really get this going every time is the topic of the Church of the Firstborn. I've seen it time and time again over the past several years. Anytime someone starts getting excited about and obsessed with the topic of the Church of the Firstborn, and they start talking about how the Latter-day Saint Church is a telestial church, it's something we graduate from, etc., etc., this is always the beginning of what pulls people off the path to apostasy. I don't know what it is about this, but that seems to be the proven pattern every time without fail. So I put a caution out there to you. If you find yourself getting caught up in these groups, be so careful. Don't chase these topics down these other paths, but put your focus and your time and your energy on why we're really here right now, what it is we're supposed to be doing. Put your time, effort, and energy into that, and I promise you, you will be so blessed for doing so. You will be so happy, and your gift of discernment will be magnified. But for some reason, these teachings continue to lead people off the path and away from their covenants. And when the leaders of these groups start to apostatize themselves, they say, it's okay, come join us. We're gonna help you enter new covenants. Leave all that behind. We're gonna show you something better, something new, something higher. You see, all of this church was just to lead you to Jesus. That was the purpose of it, was just to lead you to Him. And once you come to Him, you don't need any of that anymore. This is a distraction and it's a lie. And its purpose is to pull you away from the temple, to pull you away from that work. If everyone's getting pulled away from that, who's gonna be doing the work? Do you think for a moment the Lord Jesus Christ wouldn't want us entering His house right now in a time like this and doing the work for all of our family on the other side of the veil? That's why we're here. That's the most important work we can be doing right now, is the salvation of souls and helping them on that path towards exaltation. I don't think discernment on this could be any more clear. And I don't doubt for a second that Jesus Christ Himself has visited His apostles on the earth today. I believe with all my heart that so many of them have seen Him and have conversed with Him face to face, including President Nelson. Now, of course, He's never said that, but I believe that with all my heart. Now, we know that President Nelson receives revelation from the Lord very regularly. He converses with the Lord. He has a relationship with the Lord, as do many of His apostles. And have they felt the need to leave the church, to leave all that behind? Because now that they know Him, that was the purpose. The purpose of the church was to lead them to Him, and now that they know Him, they don't need that anymore. Of course not. Now with these groups, it's all about me, 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 or you, you, you. We want to help you on your path. We want to get you to a higher place. We want to help you have these supernatural experiences. These groups are not about helping you grow the kingdom, helping you go out and serve others with no strings attached, with no other agenda. They are offering a very self-focused path, and that's the difference. And so I ended with this. The true path is about the salvation and exaltation of families. It's not an individual thing. Those who leave the church and head down this path aren't doing the work for their families. They aren't helping their ancestors partake of the Abrahamic covenant. Their focus isn't to help God's children. They meet together to try to see angels, to try to converse through the veil with supernatural beings in hopes of having experiences and leaving their bodies. They just want supernatural experiences. They are on a search for deep hidden mysteries. It's an obsession. I've seen it. I've witnessed it myself, and I tell you right now, the mysteries are simple, and they're in plain sight. They are not secret knowledge kept in secret hidden vaults and protected by secret societies throughout the centuries. They are plain, precious, and simple, and they're right there in the scriptures for all to see, for all to experience, for all to partake of. So I continue in my thoughts. What good is any of that? When you aren't even on the Lord's errand, when you aren't actively building his kingdom, but you're building your own or someone else's. Again, Laman and Lemuel saw an angel, and they continued on the path to destruction, because none of that matters if you don't have the true spirit dwelling within you. And the sign of having the true spirit dwelling within you is humility. It's meekness and charity. These people in these groups and on these paths, they get easily offended and hot-tempered if you question what they are teaching, if you ask for clarification. Sometimes they even get downright hostile, as many of you have shared with me through your own experiences. That's when their true colors show. Okay, so enough of that, but I had to bring this up because, again, I'm seeing this come up right now. It seems to kind of be like an every other month type of thing, or every 2 months. So it'll build up, and then there's some kind of a distraction and it quiets down, and then someone pops up again and it builds up again, and I just see this time and time again, and it's almost like every time I see it happen, it's like, here we go again. And a lot of times it's the same people who gravitate to this. I see the same people on Facebook who jump in on this conversation every single time. These are people who are big supporters of and fans of energy work and the New Age movement, bringing in the abundance of the universe and balancing those chakras and all of that. And a lot of these people are silent supporters of all of those leaders who have been disfellowshipped from the church. These people are still supporting them silently behind the scenes. Just something to be aware of. I felt like I had to touch on this again. So around the time I was pondering this, there was a lady that reached out to me. She left a message on my phone, and she's someone I used to reference many years ago in my videos. She's someone I referenced in that series I did last fall, Hold to the Iron Rod. I did a 3-part video series where I talked about wolves in sheep's clothing and all of these things that I blew the whistle on, and I talked about groups, I talked about people, but I left them all anonymous. She was one of the people that I referenced, and it's been quite a few years since I've seen her or talked to her or heard from her. So it was interesting that as I was pondering these modern day Sherems and this apostasy that's happening and these groups that are springing up and just all of this deception, that she reached out to me and called me and left a message on my phone asking me to call her back. And I just felt from the spirit that I was not to call her back. I didn't know why she was calling me, she didn't say, but I just felt that I was not to call her. It was interesting because almost the very next day, I received this email from someone, and I'll just read you what she wrote. She says, "I'm not sure how I found you. I was studying my scriptures one day and opened my phone up, and your When the Missionaries Are Called Home YouTube video popped up. Yay! I have since listened to that and to your part 3 of Hold to the Rod. I finally have an answer and understanding of what happened to a dear friend that I used to refer to as my sister. She fell so hard and deep, and I always wondered where the wrong turn happened. She is a life coach and was into the emotion and body code and other stuff, and I believe you probably know her." So she says her name. We'll just call her Susan. She says, "Last night I went through and deleted all of the emails from Susan. I had a lot, some I never did read. She sent so many, I remember that. and some were odd, like about indigo children. I know that there was probably some good things in them, but there was obviously the poison of the adversary in there too. Better to delete it all. I did read one that was a copy of the email she sent to the bishop. In it, she was confused on why he called her in and counseled her to stop. She assured him firmly that she was solidly planted in the gospel and would never leave. Oh, I wish that were so. In 4+ short years, she went from a gospel-centered person to being excommunicated. And now I understand why. Even her very appearance has changed. I have some other friends that also do the same body code thing. In fact, they have practiced on me. I never, ever benefited in any way, but I always hoped it would help. I hope to reach out to them and share your message and your videos. Thank you so much for taking the time and sharing your experience. I started thinking, if I were Satan, how would I trick the valiant women of today? Exactly how he's doing it. Because we want more and we look beyond the mark. And now she refers to a prominent Latter-day Saint author who I've made reference to before. I've kept her anonymous, but I've said that her books are sold at Deseret Book and she does teach these teachings and is on this path. So she brings up this author and she says, I have followed this author for years and I appreciate and love some of the programs that she's developed. I've done it for over 8 years and I would never go back. It sounds weird to say it, but it has really blessed my life. It also has helped me to understand my husband and my children better. It has definitely helped my relationships with all of them. But recently, the same author came out with a book on chakras. I've even toyed with getting it. However, I will not be doing that now. Yikes. I'm so sad that she is doing this. I didn't even realize the evil in chakras. Anyway, she goes on to talking about how she was invited to do a Christian meditating course and she was almost considering it. And then she saw my video series and decided that was a bad idea. But it was interesting that she had mentioned that old friend of mine who I haven't talked to in years. I referenced her in past videos, but I don't follow her. I haven't heard from her. I haven't reached out to her. And I had no idea that she had been excommunicated, but it doesn't surprise me because of a lot of the things that I saw her do. I'd mentioned in a past video about her how there was one time when I was in her home and her eyes went black and she went into this daze and her mouth was hanging open, her jaw was hanging open, and she was just staring and sort of shaking. And I realized that there was something else going on with her, that wasn't the spirit, that she had something else inside of her, and it was very scary. And she was all about balancing the chakras and opening those portals in your body. She was all about speaking to beings on the other side of the veil, and I did notice too her countenance changing over the years. So it was very interesting that someone I don't even know reached out to me and shared that with me and just added that witness. So I don't believe in coincidences with the timing of all of this. It's interesting how when you start pondering something and reflecting on something, you start getting witnesses that come right across your path. And I believe that's what this was for me, just another witness that this continues to happen. And as difficult as it is to see people leave the church, it's important that all of these people who are deceiving others, that they be disfellowshipped to show everybody that it's not okay to follow these teachings, that they are dangerous. And hopefully during that time when these people are away from the church, they use that as a period of reflection and going to the Lord and repentance and then coming back to really be on the Lord's team. And they talked about that at General Conference. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But unfortunately, I truly believe that most of these people, most of these deceivers, don't even realize that they've been deceived and that they're deceiving others. They don't even realize it. So oftentimes it takes something drastic like being excommunicated for them to have that wake-up call. Unfortunately, from what I've noticed, most of the time, they never see it that way. They never see it as a wake-up call. They see it as being misunderstood and unjust, unfair, just a big misunderstanding, and they continue to pull people off the path through that thinking. But what it really is supposed to be is a wake-up call. You are officially off the path. Why? Why did this happen? Reevaluate and do a course correction quick.
I came across this book as I was cleaning out my office that I got from the Firm Expo a few years ago. And as I flipped it open to see what it was about and what was inside, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. The book is called The Master Healer and the Word, and so you're led to think it's about the healing power of Jesus Christ. But as you open up the book, the contents of the book contain a glossary of all the different energy modalities that will help you heal. But according to the book, it's through Jesus Christ. This first one, it brings up Reiki, and it says, this modality is also the direct result of much prayer and fasting. While body code and emotion code remove energies and emotions, this modality installs the healing power of divinely charged words and emotions. And it goes on and on. Now remember, if you've seen my 3-part video series where I talk about the truth about all of this, about energy work, and the blog post that I've included a link to down below in this video description, where I uncover what really goes on with these particular energy modalities, what they really are, what they really do. And this is from actual experience of masters who have mastered these modalities and realized it was demonic in every way. And from their experiences and from what they were trained to do and what they were training others to do and what they encountered in their own personal lives, this just tells you that this is not of Jesus Christ. This is such deception. And I couldn't believe this was put into a book under the name of Jesus Christ and being sold at a Book of Mormon evidence conference to so many people. Here's what it says about emotion and body code. It says, through prayer, fasting, and study of energy healing arts, this modality is remarkable. Now remember, I once was a practicing body code practitioner, and I'm here to tell you, as you know from past videos and what I've shared from past experiences, this is counterfeit of God's true healing power. She even goes on to recommend getting trained and certified in these different energy modalities and explains how to go about doing so. And I'm just blown away at how much the New Age movement and energy healing and all of this deception is creeping into these other conferences that used to purely just be about the Book of Mormon or about the gospel. And then, of course, when she brings up yoga and Tai Chi, she talks about it in a manner of it's just healthy stretching and relaxing, and it's so beneficial for you. But as I've shared and uncovered in my past video messages, yoga is anything but just relaxing and stretching. It is much, much more than that. Now, speaking of healing, let's talk about the true source of healing, the real power of healing. A friend of mine shared this on Facebook, and I absolutely loved it, so I think this is the perfect place to share this. She said, my aunt shared this personal story of hers and gave me permission to share it. My parents are devout Latter-day Saints. My story begins as my dad has completed a labor mission for the church on the island of Tonga, Tapu, after which it became necessary for us to remove to the island of Vavao. This would be our home for the next several years. It was while we lived here that I contracted a debilitating disease, which exhibited itself in a profusion of boils all over my body. To this day, I do not recall that other members of my family were as unfortunate. I believe I was the only one. Some of the boils were as large as golf balls and were manifest behind my legs, my armpits, my buttocks, and my back. I can only remember excruciating pain. As if that were not enough, the invasion moved to the top of my head. This would cause the loss of my hair either through falling out of its own accord or because my mother cut it so that she could treat my head. This meant, of course, that I was bald, and that broke my 6-year-old heart. Attending school was terrifying because I would have to wear a turban-like affair to cover my head, but there was no getting around the local bullies who found it great sport to remove my headwear, and eventually I stopped going to school. To avoid the pain and humiliation, my head was like a big scab. My mother taught primary. One Sunday, she was teaching the story of the woman who had touched the hem of the Savior's garment. You will recall that the Savior, feeling the virtue had gone out of him, asked, "Who touched me?" Upon discovering that it was the woman taken in sin, he said to her, "Woman, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go thy way and sin no more." As my mother told the story, I wished with all my heart that I could touch the Savior, so that I too could be healed. Of course, this was impossible, But then Mother mentioned that the Savior's prophet, David O. McKay, would be arriving at our island the very next week. She said that because he was a prophet, he had the power to heal just like Jesus did. In an instant, I knew what I would do. I determined then and there that I would touch the prophet. For the next week, that was all I thought about. The important day had arrived, and I never told anyone of my plan. I was so emotionally charged that I ran off and forgot to wear my underclothes. I managed to get in the long line. It was very hot, driving my head crazy. The sores on my head burned and made me cry. I cried very quietly because I did not want anyone to know that I was crying. The line took forever, and I kept being pushed behind the big people. It began to look hopeless, but something happened. It felt like someone just picked me up and set me right in front. Well, there I was, right in front of the prophet of God. Both of my hands were clasped behind me, and I was shaking. He beckoned me, and then picked me up and engulfed me in his arms. He looked into my eyes and said, "I love you." I was still wearing my scarf on my head. Never had I experienced such a feeling. The warmth of it coursed through my entire body. It was only for a moment, but like the woman who touched the Savior's garment was healed, I heard the Savior's voice in my heart. "Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole." I felt the depth of the Savior's love in him. And when he put me down, I ran to the chapel, where I found a table fully draped over with tapa cloth. I crawled under, and with all the energy of my soul, I prayed, "Heavenly Father, thank you for sending me the prophet." My parents were beside themselves because they had been looking all over for me. 2 days later, my head developed what I called an eternal itch. Mother wrapped my head in warm, moist towels, and then later, when she removed them, it was to find, to her surprise, that my head was clear. The boils on my body had disappeared. I was healed. I knew that it was because I was able to touch the prophet and shake his hand. I never told anyone about this story until I was 18, and then in America. President McKay was still my prophet, and I was able to shake his hand once more. I wanted so much to tell him my story, but as yet I still had not mastered the English language, and so I just cried again as the memories came flooding back. When his hand enfolded mine, I knew that somehow he already knew. Wow, I love this story. I absolutely loved her faith. You see, I believe what heals us is our faith in Jesus Christ. And if our faith in Jesus Christ and his power means our faith in his priesthood holders, our faith in his prophet, then so be it. But it's our faith in Jesus Christ and his healing power that truly heals us time and time again. Notice that no energy healing or energy modalities were involved in this little girl's healing. It was just simply her faith in Jesus Christ, his power, and his prophet.
Okay, moving on. As I've shared in past video messages, a lot of people who leave the church and start their own church or their own organization, for some reason, a lot of the time, they like to use the name, the Church of the Firstborn, in their organization name or in their church name. And I've talked about this before. I've given examples of this before. But I was reminded again of an example I've shared in a video way back of the first time this happened in the church. This was in the 1800s, and I was reminded of this when I was listening to The Saints, Volume 2, and they brought this up. It all began with this man right here. Doesn't he just look full of light? His name was Joseph Morris, and he was an English convert to the church in 1857. That is, until he started reporting that he was receiving revelations, and in these personal revelations, he was being taught that he was the seventh angel from the book of Revelation. The reason this stands out to me every time I hear this is because I have been in a room before with
people who received, if not similar, the exact same revelation for themselves. And I heard them say, I've received this revelation that I am one of the seven angels in the book of Revelation and that I'm here on assignment. Or I've had people tell me that. I think I've talked about this in past video messages. I've had people come up to me and say, I received revelation that you are one of the archangels, and on and on and on. So when he received this revelation, he wrote the prophet and he wanted recognition from the church to say, yes, we recognize that you are the seventh archangel. Well, it's no surprise that the church did not respond to him. He sent many letters, which were all ignored. So in 1860, he began to collect followers and he formed a group that became known as the Morrisites. And in February 1861, he was finally excommunicated from the church. So he and his followers organized a church that they named the Church of the Firstborn. And of course, that didn't last long. By the 1950s, most of the members had died, and the church was officially disbanded in 1969. So it's interesting, in his new church, he still recognized that Joseph Smith was a prophet of God and recognized a lot of those teachings, but he introduced the belief of reincarnation. I've talked about that in past video messages, how these modern day groups teach reincarnation. They teach that they are here as former angels, they're here on assignment, they were some past prophet or the wife of a past prophet. This is what Lori and Chad Daybell believe. This is what they teach. And many other groups that I've made reference to in my past videos have also taught this, which has also led to them leaving the church, either by excommunication or by their own choice.
In 2007, in Nampa, Idaho, a woman whom I have since met personally incorporated this church called the Church of the Firstborn of Nampa Incorporated, after she had been excommunicated from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. If you're familiar with Abraham Hicks, that's exactly what she does, and she believes that she channels Jesus Christ as well as many other beings on the other side of the veil and people from history. And she has written books that are supposedly Jesus Christ speaking, and she is anonymous as the writer of those books. She's led a lot of people away from the church. She's led a lot of people away from their covenants, and she's led a lot of people away from their marriages. Her church dissolved in 2010, and she moved to Utah and now has a following out here and has started a new organization with members both inside and outside of the church. In fact, this woman is the main influencer of many other leaders and teachers who started doing their own podcasts and holding special firesides, and they started teaching the same information, which also led to their excommunication. Here's another example of this. This is from a news story that broke in 2009, and here it says, in June, KSL News followed a caravan as the cult consolidated its members and moved to Idaho. They left Utah for greener pastures in Idaho, but their new neighbors worry that the pasture is getting too crowded. It says this group is called the Church of the Firstborn and the General Assembly of Heaven. And it went on to say that according to their website, the president and founder of the church was told by God around 2000 that he was one of the two witnesses written about in the Bible. He wrote on the website that he then began to question some of the things that he was taught in his upbringing in the church. He said, now God in his great understanding of things had already caused me to start a church called the Church of the Firstborn. So when the LDS leaders decided to excommunicate me from the church, things had already progressed to the point that it really did not matter. For the Lord himself came down and laid his hands upon my head and blessed me with all the keys and priesthoods and gifts, and ordained me as the first elder in the Church of the Firstborn. It then talked about how law enforcement got involved with this group because there were rumors spreading that this group was planning to assassinate a lot of government leaders because of their beliefs. They felt that they were called by God to do so. This sounds, again, a lot like Lori and Chad Daybell. And these are just a few examples of the many examples that are out there where people get very obsessed with this topic of being a member of the Church of the Firstborn. This obsession led them down paths where they ended up communicating with beings on the other side of the veil that told them they had a different identity than what they knew, and that their mission was very unique and special, and that they were being counted on to do certain things for humanity and mankind.
So these are the patterns, these are the red flags. This isn't anything new. I've talked about this before in several past video messages, but as you can see, this goes clear back to the 1800s. This is nothing new. So whenever you're in a group or you're in a conversation with someone and they start talking about things like this, receiving personal revelation that goes against the teachings of the church, that puts them on a pedestal above the church, that teaches reincarnation or multiple probations, multiple mortalities. There's so many different names that they call it, but it's all the same thing. See it for what it is and take no part in it. You can reject it politely, or you don't even have to tell them that you reject it. You can just disassociate with them. But I tell you, if you explore those teachings and you explore those paths, they only lead to apostasy every time. They are false teachings and they are a huge distraction as to why we are here and what we are to be doing, where we are to be putting our time and our energy. Don't fall for it. All right, now I want to share those aha moments that some of my friends have shared with me. I heard someone say the other day that the purpose of the Passover was, of course, to free the Lord's people from oppression. So isn't it interesting where a lot of us have been noticing and feeling that what we're experiencing right now is very much like the Passover? It's almost like a repeat. So if that's true, then it would be a repeat of what happens with Moses and the Israelites. They were clearly oppressed and God needed them to be free because he had a purpose for them. Today, are we not seeing more and more oppression happening in this world? Are we not seeing more and more of our freedoms being taken away, being stripped from us? I've talked about in past videos how we're being oppressed through censorship online. There's a lot of things that we can't say because if we do, our posts will be taken down, our videos will be taken down, we could lose those accounts. So there's certain lines that we cannot cross. We don't really have that freedom of speech. And a lot of the Lord's people all over the world experience persecution on a daily basis. So if this is a repeat of history, then the Lord might be trying to free us from the current oppression, from the system of the world. Just something to think about. I encourage you to go study the book of Exodus, to read about everything that happened to the Israelites, what they went through, what Moses went through, and what God did to free them. Because I believe if you do, you're going to pick up on a lot of similarities that we're experiencing today. And it might give you an idea of what to expect for things to come. So a friend of mine shared her notes with me about the subject, and she gave me permission to share this, and I'm going to keep her anonymous. But she had journaled her thoughts about this, and she shared that with me. So I'm going to read you her thoughts. She wrote, "Wow, this last week has been amazing. The spirit has been so strong and so near, like when my mom died, except no pain, just pure peace and joy. I have so much to say that I'm not sure where to even start. I should have been recording every day, but here I am now trying to play catch up. During conference, we had a solemn assembly to celebrate the bicentennial of the Restoration. We participated in the Hosanna shout." Then she shares a post from someone in the 11th Hour group. So, quote, "Just some thoughts. When Jesus had his triumphal entry, it was Passover, and he came for that. The people waved palm leaves and shouted to him in joy. He cleansed the temple, or his father's house, of the wicked money changers. He had the Last Supper, which was at Passover dinner. After that, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane and suffered everything this world had endured or was going to suffer. Then he was betrayed by a friend, bound and sent to prison as a captive and then persecuted, mocked, falsely accused, and sentenced to death, and then crucified while being spat upon and mocked and persecuted, and then died, and the earth groaned, there were storms, earthquakes happened because of the wickedness of killing the Creator. Then 3 days later, he came back and was resurrected. Could it in similitude be in a similar manner
the tribulation time period, where Jesus had his second triumphal entry with this Hosanna shout we just did on Palm Sunday, right before Passover, and that now he will cleanse his Father's house, the temple or the church, his people, first. And then all the persecution, mockery, betrayals, scourging, sufferings, being bound and captive, imprisoned by tyrants that were religious and government tyrants, then deaths and storms and groaning of the earth all come together in a short span of time, just like the bridegroom had all these things happen in a short span of time. And instead of the victory over death with his first coming as winning over death and being resurrected, but this time he wins the victory over all the tyrants and now rules and reigns as Lord of Lords and Kings of Kings here. So my friend said, this really stood out to me that this Holy Week for us may have some parallels to the Savior's last week here on earth. So I began studying what each day the Savior did on his last week on earth. On the day the Savior cursed the fig tree and threw the money changers out of the temple, my family had a discussion and this is how it went. I asked if anyone had any insight on why the Savior would curse the fig tree. Her daughter said, in the seminary manual, it suggests that Jesus may have cursed the fruit, symbolic of the fruitlessness of the Jewish leaders. If we think of the fruit of the gospel, by their fruits ye shall know them. This makes a lot of sense. However, it definitely does not state that purpose as definitive in the manual. In the Bible dictionary, it simply says the fruitlessness of Israel. In Jesus the Christ, it shares the insight that it may have leaves, but bear no fruit, suggesting that it would be a hypocritical tree. With all these references and your thoughts together, it makes me think about the apostasy that would soon come. Knowing that Christ would be crucified and that his apostles would be killed, his cursing on the tree could be because the gospel would be taken from the earth. All that would be left are those claiming to be of God, but bearing no fruit. Another thought, just like it bears leaves and no fruit, the Jews were searching for signs of the coming Messiah, but were not looking in the correct places. They rejected him, but still looked for the Messiah's coming, missing the actual signs and looking to other things. She shares a comment that someone added. I was on a morning walk when I read your thoughts. I remember learning about this topic in my Book of Mormon Institute class. They rejected him, but still looked for the Messiah's coming, missing the actual signs and looking to other things. So she mentions the scripture, they draw near to him with their lips, but their hearts are far from him. But woe unto them that are deceivers and hypocrites, for thus saith the Lord, I will bring them to judgment. Behold, verily I say unto you, there are hypocrites among you who have deceived some, which has given the adversary power. But behold, such shall be reclaimed. But the hypocrite shall be detected and shall be cut off, either in life or in death, even as I will. And woe unto them who are cut off from my church, for the same are overcome of the world. And then she mentions, it's interesting that the Lord would curse the fig tree and cleanse the temple on the same day. He's cleansing his people and cursing the wicked in the same day. The Lord is clearly cleansing his people right now. And then she shared a post that Beth had shared in our group. And it says, the word quarantine stems from an Italian word that means 40. Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights. The flood lasted 40 days. It was 40 days before Moses received the tablets. Usually these 40-day scriptures are more figurative than literal, and they represent a time away from the world or a period of time in which they were able to come closer to God or prepare for their mission. It seems incredibly symbolic that we are currently going through a 40-day period where we are gathering in with our families and spending time away from the world, coming closer to God. What are we being prepared for? What is on the horizon? What changes will have happened when the figurative doors of the ark are open back up to the world? She says, right now the righteous are being cleansed and maybe the wicked are being cursed, We will have to see. And then there is Passover. For those who will be fasting and praying on Friday, she then shares something from Facebook. And it says, "This week presents one of the most ironic symbolic situations I have ever seen. Sunday is Easter. Thursday is Passover. During the Savior's last week, he celebrated the Passover on Thursday, just before his crucifixion and resurrection. The Israelites celebrated the Passover to invite God to deliver them from death. And here we are. Our prophet, President Nelson, invited the entire world to fast on Good Friday for an end to this pandemic. What he didn't mention out loud is that this means our last meal would be the Passover meal on Thursday night. Our last supper before we petition the Savior, before we petition the Savior of the world for healing, corresponds to the anniversary of his last supper. Wow. And that Passover meal is the symbol of divine rescue from disease and death. Coincidence? I don't think so. It's amazing. The God we are praying to for deliverance at this very moment is the one who gave us the Passover to remind us of his power to deliver. Then my friend continues, "A great miracle has happened this week. We witnessed an incredible miracle that has never in the history of the world ever happened before. Many, many faiths from all over the world united. People who have been estranged from faith returning to their roots. People who have never even learned of faith, they all came together to fast on Good Friday, April 10th, my son's birthday. This day commemorates the day that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was tried and hung on the cross to die for our redemption. This will be a very significant and historic day indeed." She shares more. "It's the 3,333rd year since the first Passover. And our world population is about to reach 7,777,777,777. I think I said that wrong. Anyways, 10 sevens. And all of the things that are lining up are so amazing." She shares from someone else, "The number 7, used over 800 times in the Bible. 7 is the number of completeness and perfection, both physical and spiritual. It derives much of its meaning from being tied directly to God's creation of all things. There are 7 days in the week, and God's Sabbath is on the 7th day. We just began the 7th millennium since Adam and Eve left the garden. There are 7 annual holy days. Jesus performed 7 miracles on God's holy Sabbath day, and there are 7 seals. And I just want to add to that, that the adversary always mimics everything that is of the Lord. And I've shared in a past blog post how the adversary mimics the number 7. There were 7 devils cast out of Mary. And as I've also mentioned, in the Hindu religion, there are 7 portals of the body controlled by 7 gods, which former Hindus who have now turned Christian have shared that those are actually 7 demonic portals, and those 7 Hindu gods are actually 7 demons. So I talk all about that in that post. If you've not read that before, I have a link to it down below. She goes on to say, "The number 3 biblically represents divine wholeness, completeness, and perfection. If there ever was a desire to highlight an idea, thought, event, or noteworthy figure in the Bible for their prominence, the number 3 was used to put a divine stamp of completion or fulfillment on the subject." So interesting how both numbers mean completeness and perfection. All right, another friend added to this subject, and I didn't ask permission from him, so I'm going to keep him anonymous, but he said, "The Latin root of the word quarantine is 40. So what does the Bible say about 40? The flood lasted 40 days, 40 years Moses fled Egypt, 40 days Moses stayed on Mount Sinai to receive the commandments. Exodus lasted 40 years. Jesus fasted 40 days. Lent is 40 days. 40 days for a woman to rest after giving birth. A group of theologians thinks the number 40 represents change. It is the time of preparing a person or a people to make a fundamental change. Something will happen after these 40 days. Just believe and pray. Remember, whenever the number 40 appears in the Bible, there is a change. Please know that during this quarantine, rivers are clearing up, vegetation is growing, the air is becoming clearer and cleaner because of less pollution. There is less theft and murder. Healing is happening, and most importantly, people are turning to Christ. The earth is at rest for the first time in many years, and hearts are truly transforming. So, during this time, enjoy it with your loved ones and return to the family altar together. Family prayer is a great blessing. Through prayer, you will see the changes God can work in you and in your home. Christ promises us that everything works together for the good of those who love God. Romans 8:28. Remember, we are in the year 2020. And 20 plus 20 equals 40. Also, 2020 is the year of the United States Census. Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, was born during a census. Lastly, 2020 is perfect vision. May our sight focus on the Lord and living according to His perfect vision for us, knowing He holds us in the palm of His hand. May these days of quarantine bring spiritual liberation to our souls, our nation, and our world. The best is yet to come. Trust in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So my friend reached out to me the other day and she shared something with me and she said, "Hey, did you see this? Did you notice this?" And I actually had, but she was the first person to reach out to me about it. And so she shares a quote from the email that came from the church that talked about which ordinances we can perform in our homes right now and how to go about doing that. And the First Presidency said in their quote, "Directions are enclosed for essential ordinances, blessings, and other church functions to guide leaders through the current crisis and the challenging days that are ahead." So right there, they're telling us, if we're paying attention, that yes, there is a crisis right now. Yes, this isn't easy, but there are more challenging days that lie ahead. So that was sort of a confirmation for what we've all been feeling. And my friend commented, she said, "As I've been studying the restoration, I've been feeling that the saints will be going through great afflictions before the second coming because He will need to purify His people like He did before He allowed the early pioneers to reach Zion." It just really brings to light that they didn't escape afflictions. They were blessed as they were faithful and endured affliction. The hope, though, is that even though the saints suffered hard times, they did see so many miracles through their faith. And I think there were more happy times than hard times. I've heard that as well. That's the brightness of hope we have to look forward to, is as times get more difficult and challenging, well, that just means the miracles get so much better. And then the last thing she pointed out to me that was pretty interesting, I'd never studied it before, she asked me, "Do you have any insight on east wind in the scriptures? We noticed it in the Come Follow Me reading this week. And as we cross-referenced, it seems to symbolize destruction. But I was just wondering if you know of why the east wind might symbolize destruction." Well, I didn't know, so I looked into it, and here's what I found. It sounds like the east winds in the Mediterranean area are a real thing. They are known to be extremely destructive. So when people mentioned east winds, especially in that region, everyone understands that that symbolizes destruction. And then she responded that she found in a seminary teaching manual that the Greek word for spirit is pneuma, P-N-E-U-M-A, which also can be translated as breath or wind, so the east spirit. And then I shared a link with her that said that the common Hebrew word for wind is ruah, R-U-A-H, which can also have the figurative meaning of spirit. But there is a special word for the eastern wind, which is kadim, K-A-D-I-M, for which comes from the root K-D-M, meaning east, or in front of. This is because in the mindset of the people of the Bible, one stands eastward looking towards the rising sun. And she replied, "So I think the connection of east wind may mean a destruction that would point us toward God." To which I replied, "A divine destruction." She said, "I wonder if the east wind is signifying the Lord's last attempt to humble hearts and get the wicked to look to Him or the rising sun." She said, "You know how it's said in Doctrine and Covenants that once the elders are called home, then the Lord will begin preaching with earthquakes and such. I wonder if the east wind is signifying the Lord's last attempt to humble hearts and get the wicked to look to him or the rising sun. Then she shared with me some thoughts that her sister had about this. She said, "It seems we are firsthand seeing the east wind for the first time in our lifetime that we know of. But we have heard of these destructive forces in the scriptures multiple times. It intrigued me. I'm fascinated by the definition of wind of deity, which tells me it's definitely a wind that was sent by God. This would legitimize the theory that the east wind is being sent by God to humble the people and free them from spiritual bondage, which takes me back to 2 Nephi 28 verse 19, for the kingdom of the devil must shake, and they which belong to it must needs be stirred up unto repentance, or the devil will grasp them with his everlasting chains, and they be stirred up to anger and perish." Here's another reference by Elder Renlund. The fictional character Mary Poppins is a typical English nanny who happens to be magical. She blows in on the east wind to help the troubled Banks family of number 17 Cherry Tree Lane in Edwardian London. She is given charge of the children, Jane and Michael, in a firm but kind manner. She begins to teach them valuable lessons with an enchanting touch. His talk goes on to read, "Jane and Michael make considerable progress, but Mary decides that it is time for her to move on. In the stage production, Mary's chimney sweep friend, Bert, tries to dissuade her from leaving. He argues, 'But they're good kids, Mary.' Mary replies, 'Would I be bothering them if they weren't? But I can't help them if they won't let me, and there's no one so hard to teach as the child who knows everything.' Bert asks, 'So?' Mary answers, 'So they've got to do the next bit on their own.'" That was in the October 2018 conference. This signifies that the east wind is sent to stir up the hearts, but that agency still plays a role in the process. After they have been ruffled, this gives them the opportunity to rethink their path, and then they must choose. The power is in the choice. That is how you access the power of God each time you make a choice for good. It does not matter what level you are on. If you are in depth of hollow despair, or if you are among the 12 apostles, the recipe is the same, and the power is accessed each time you make a choice, no matter what circumstances you are in. My friend says, "Isn't it interesting how it seems that the world rallied in the most evil powers with the Super Bowl halftime show, and then General Conference seems to have welcomed in or rallied in all the most heavenly powers, and even the Savior himself?" And one last final detail. In regards to the east wind, she says, "Also, the symbolism of the east, meaning it comes from God, just as Christ will rise in the east. And the east wind differentiates the random destructions with specific forces sent from God." And that is why the angel Moroni statues that stands on top of all of our temples, he faces towards the east. He blows his trumpet towards the east, looking for the return of the Messiah. So all this talking about wind reminded me of the recent tornadoes that tore through the south, through Alabama. And check this out, as they came over this area where there were the three crosses representing Jesus Christ and the two that were at his side, the two crosses on the side had fallen from the tornado, but the center cross remained standing through a very powerful and destructive storm. That's very symbolic. The Lord is letting everyone know, "I have power over all of this. Look for me in these storms. Build your life on my foundation because it's solid. It will not be destroyed in the storm." I loved that. Okay, I had another conversation with a friend through text, and we talked about quite a bit, and it's too much to share, so I'm just gonna break it down to some highlights. But she shared this screenshot right here with me. We see a lot of the same numbers all the time. And she showed me on the screenshot, as you can see, 44 and 14. And it says on the screenshot, "There is motion at your front door." And she said, "The thought just came to my mind that with that notification above, motion at your door, I had the vision of Christ knocking at the door." She shared this image right here. "It felt very significant, especially with that number 14 that makes me think of the Savior." So I responded, "So yesterday on Facebook, someone said, 'Let's play I Spy.'
and post a picture on your camera roll of something that has red in it. I said, I went through my roll and I found a screenshot of the exact picture you just shared. It was red, so I shared it. I felt there was something trying to get my attention, and that's why I felt prompted to play I Spy, which I normally wouldn't. Then you just shared that now, and the 1:44, we both looked at our clocks at that time. Wow, the Lord is saying something. She said, I have more to add. I was sharing these same thoughts with a smaller group, and I accidentally sent that picture 3 times. I almost deleted the extra 2, and then I felt not to. I asked why, and I heard knock 3 times. So I responded, I told my kids that maybe Jesus will begin to visit our homes as we turn them into holy places. When Elder Anderson talked about hearing Christ and him revealing himself and some experiences that are too sacred to share, it reminded me of what I had just said to my kids. I loved Elder Anderson's talk, by the way. And then we talked about the announcement at General Conference, where President Nelson announced that we were moving away from the symbol of the angel Moroni blowing the trumpet, which is funny because the angel Moroni blowing the trumpet,
his trumpet,
just fell off the Salt Lake Temple last month during the earthquake. And it's so symbolic. He fell off the temple, and then a couple weeks later, President Nelson announces that we're not using that as our symbol anymore. Instead, we're using the Christus statue, Jesus Christ. He is now the symbol of our church. He is on the logo. Because it's his church. It's the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And so a lot of people have reached out to me and said, it almost sounds like that they are showing us that they are handing over the church to him. After all, it is his church. And that reminded me of a video I shared in January of 2019. And in that video, I referenced a video I had watched of a woman who talked about Elder Holland coming to their state conference, and he said something similar to, right now, the first presidency is preparing to hand the church over to Jesus Christ himself. And she shared that experience and what it was like. And as I thought about this, I reflected back on that video. It really does seem like they're trying to tell us something. And my friend said, interesting that the church's symbol before was Angel Moroni. He sounded or dropped the trumpet, and now the Savior is the new symbol. And of course, right when she sent that to me, it was 11/13/113. She went on to share with me some amazing stuff, and there's so much of it. I'm gonna touch on some highlights, but I've taken all of these screenshots that she sent me from her cousin's post, and I've put them into a blog post, and I have the link down below if you wanna check that out. But this is fascinating. So I'm just gonna share with you some of the highlights.
Now, I'm skipping over a lot of this, but I have included all of this in a blog post, and I have the link down below if you want to read the full story. But I'm going to start here. This is installment 2. And she writes, around 4,000 years ago, there lived a family with 12 sons. This family was promised to be set up as a blessing to the world as its spiritual caretakers. Unfortunately, many of the brothers allowed jealousy and strife to cloud their judgment, resulting in the banishment of their then youngest brother to Egypt. We all know the story. His sojourn into the oldest and greatest surviving empire of the time was unknown to his family. The family was that of Jacob, otherwise known as Israel, son of Isaac. And Jacob's unfortunate 11th son, the 12th, would be born later. Joseph of Egypt, who many believe to be the great Imhotep, vizier to the Pharaoh of Egypt, in what mainstream historians call the Third Dynasty. Joseph's adventures were many, but for our purposes, we're only going to focus on a tiny part of his life. The historical Imhotep was a master architect, physician, astronomer, politician, counselor, second in power only to the Pharaoh. Same with our biblical Joseph, who even married a daughter of the king. Don't get me started on date discrepancies. I'd bore you to death explaining how it's possible to reconcile the supposed 500-year difference. Why is the Egyptian nation so important to our story? Well, because Joseph happened to become the savior of his entire family years after he became a slave in Egypt. Genesis tells us of Joseph acting as overseer, integral in designing, constructing, and running the storehouse site where the great devastating famine arrived. And what do we find at Saqqara in Egypt today in the very temple or pyramid complex of the Pharaoh of Egypt of that time that was constructed to his trusted Imhotep? That's right, granaries with corn kernels still found throughout the masonry. Okay, I'm skipping over the part where she explains the process of how the people would come and get their grain. So you'll just want to visit that later and check it out. But she talks about this practice and she says the importance of this practice, the rehearsal that would come later down the road, it may surprise you, it was the family tent, also known as sekha, a booth, a tabernacle, a temporary dwelling place of refuge. This important image was also symbolized by the tallit, the prayer shawl worn around the shoulders by Israelites that would be placed over the head for prayers. The prayer shawl. It was also represented by the canopy used overhead during Jewish wedding ceremonies to this day. It also translates as manger in the New Testament. Yep, the manger wasn't a cave, she says, inaccurately depicted in the recent nativity short film produced by my church. It was a temporary tent set up to house the overflow of transient residents throughout Israel during the great census of Augustus. And by the way, where do you think the word Saqqara comes from anyway? That's right, the Sekha, Saqqara, place of temporary booths, tabernacles. The Egyptian and Hebrew languages are understandably intertwined given Israel's sojourn in that empire. Incidentally, Imhotep taught the Egyptians about mummification. Guess what Joseph requested before he died? That his people would mummify his body, preserving it for hundreds, if not thousands of years. Why? Because he wanted his bones and those of his father to be removed from Egypt and carried back to the land of Abraham, back to Israel, a promise that would be kept. But that's a different story, one that we'll cover in the next installment. And then she points out this image and says, by the way, I noticed some years back that the reconstructed gates at Saqqara match exactly the false doors etched into Egyptian tombs. These false doors were to allow the spirit of the dead individual inside of the tomb to get out of the burial chamber to the food offering that had been left for him or her in a designated area without. So it looks like this incident caused the Egyptians themselves to institute a rehearsal of the event that changed a nation forever. Back to Egypt. Devastated by this awful curse, Pharaoh allowed the Hebrews to leave the kingdom for the three-day worship of their god in the desert. He never intended that they leave permanently. The Egyptians, tired of these troublesome Israelites, gave their gold, silver, brass, and other precious things to the Israelites to be offerings to the angry unseen god Moses kept warning Pharaoh about. The gold would soon become a certain golden calf to be eventually consumed and pooped out by the disobedient Israelites. The brass, the brazen lavar set up outside the tabernacle complex. The children of Israel commenced their journey with no intention of returning, but first they had important business, the gathering of Joseph's and Jacob's bones. The exit from Egypt, or the Exodus, is recounted in the book of Exodus. These people who had spent their entire lives for generations settled in the center for pagan worship and practices made a vital pit stop at a place which translates as Succoth, a derivative of Sekha. Most historians surmise this location is east of Hebrews' land in Goshen, which is in the northern fertile delta of Egypt. Is that where Joseph's mummy rested, awaiting return to the land of his birth? Unlikely. Joseph was most probably buried a bit south of Saqqara. The Egyptian place named for the Sekha, tabernacle, of dusty travelers seeking grain against the terrible seven-year famine hundreds of years before. There is an excellent chance that Saqqara is the actual place of the biblical Succoth, the place where Israel's descendants collected the remains of their progenitors. When Pharaoh's spies reported that the Hebrew slaves were not returning after the third day of supposed worship in the desert, the enraged ruler set out to force them to come back. Moses had fled with the entire company of Hebrew slaves and with Egyptian treasure to boot. The Israelites miraculously crossed the Sinai Peninsula in 7 days, reaching the eastern arm of the Red Sea, the Sea of Aqaba, on the 21st day of the month. Remember these benchmark days. Most of us know the story of the parting of the Red Sea. In fact, the exact site of that crossing has been located. But that's another story. As in the sojourn of Moses and his people in the wilderness. But we know that a tabernacle, a beautiful sukkah, was constructed to house the Ark of the Covenant, the throne of Jehovah. Jehovah himself tabernacled with his people, the family of Abraham. Next, she goes on to talk about the Feast of Trumpets, and she says, "Ready for your mind to be blown? You've been warned." We're now at about 3,000 years ago, upon settling on Mount Moriah, the place where Jerusalem now sits. King David instituted ordinances, rehearsals, symbols of covenants made with Jehovah, shadow pictures of good things to come. Some were old, from the days of Moses, and some were new and unique to the geography of Israel. Jerusalem was built next to the highest peak where Isaac was nearly sacrificed, the place called Jehovah Yireh. The highest peak was the dugout, becoming a ditch or road just in front of the main gate of the city on the south side of Mount Moriah. A natural formation, a skull, loomed in the cliff above said road. The meaning of Golgotha, place of the skull. The calendar of the ancient Hebrews was not a fixed thing. It was a fluid reckoning, constantly dependent upon God in its cycles. No one knew in advance the hour nor the day each new year would begin. But they did recognize the times and the seasons. The modem, what we would loosely call months. An excellent example of this is in the biblical Rosh Hashanah, rather than the modern Jewish New Year, which was changed to the fall by rabbinical Jews over 1,500 years ago. Let's examine how the true Rosh Hashanah, head of the year, occurring on Aviv Abib 1, worked. At the approach of spring, the barley fields carefully planted months before would be constantly checked to see if they were Abib, pronounced Aviv. This word basically means ripened. As the end of the 12th month of the year approached, the barley fields would either be found to be ripe or not, or in other words, the word Abib or Aviv. If it was not Aviv, the leap month of Adar Bet would begin at the first sighting of the new moon, and the new year would await about 4 more weeks. After the barley was declared Aviv, the Rosh Hashanah, head of the year, the new year day, would officially begin, and the spring feasts were imminent. Another unpredictable day of note was Yom Teruah, feast or day of trumpets. The Israelites knew approximately when this day would come, recognizing the times and the seasons, but would not know the exact day or hour of its arrival. At the new moon of the 6th month, the people were to wash their special garments, cleanse themselves, and prepare for the trumpets to sound in the feast of Tishri 1, the first day of the 7th month. At the first sighting of the sliver of the new moon, the men of the city would drop everything and run up to the closed gates at the Temple Mount. It being night, remember that days began at sundown. They would shout up to the Kohanim, priests above, "We have sighted the new moon." The temple guards at the gates would select 2 witnesses from among the men and summon a member of the Sanhedrin, the elders of Israel, to interview these selected witnesses. The elder, after interviewing the 2 witnesses, would verify the report and assemble all the elders into the hall of hewn stone, which was directly adjacent to the Temple Mount complex, with access both inside the complex and outside it. The full complement of Sanhedrin would ask an accounting of the witnessing of the new moon sighting, then confirm it before reporting such to the high priest, or Cohen Gadol, who was waiting on the Temple Mount. After this confirmation by the Sanhedrin, the Kohen Gadol would shout down to the two witnesses waiting again at the gates, "Come up hither! Only this high priest has the authority to open the temple gates." The two would ascend and give witness. The Kohen Gadol would then shout, "Sound the shofars," or trumpets, ram's horns. At hearing the trumpet blast from the top of Mount Moriah, a sentry on the Mount of Olives to the east of the city would light a massive pile of wood. Other sentries all throughout the land would then light their own prepared pillars of fire, signaling to the next sentry that the sighting of the new moon had been confirmed. Soon, the entire nation of Israel would be alight with fire, and the good news that a new season, the celebration, had officially begun. Those who had neglected to prepare for the feast, either by not having washed, hung, and stretched their garments, or if they had not washed themselves, mikvah, it was too late. They had missed the summons. Thus began the day of announcements, the day of trumpets, Yom Teruah. No one knew the exact date or hour it would begin, but they did recognize when to wait and watch, for the times and seasons had been explained to them. And what happens just before the return of Christ? No more will he be the suffering servant, but the Lord of hosts. Sword in hand, as he sits up above, the day of trumpets shall be partially fulfilled when the two specially selected slain witnesses lying dead in the streets of Jerusalem for 3 days will arise and shout up that their mission is fulfilled, their testimony complete. Thereupon the Kohen Gadol, Yeshua the Messiah, keeper of the gate of heaven, shall call down, "Come up hither." They shall give their account. The Savior will command the trumps to blow, and he shall light the world with his radiance. Those who have neglected to prepare will not be a part of the feast of the bridegroom. And I'm feeling it right now. I've got my spirit bumps. This holy mikra will not be entirely complete until the end of the end, after Messiah's millennial reign, when the trumpets shall blast once more and the earth shall burn and become the sea of glass and fire. Now we see an example of how ordinances, shadow pictures of good things to come, shall be fulfilled. Will we recognize them? No one knows the day or the hour, but we have the tools to learn to recognize the times and the seasons or rehearsals. She says, side note, many important dates regarding the reorganization of the Church of Jesus Christ correspond to the ancient Hebrew mikras, or rehearsals, feasts. Example, Moroni handed the golden plates to Joseph Smith on the Day of Trumpets, Yom Teruah, September 22nd, 1827. Okay, skipping ahead. About 2,000 years ago, the barley had been proclaimed as Aviv, or ripe. Thus began another new year, full of promise. It was now Aviv 10, the day of making a very important selection. The Kohen Gadol, or high priest, had no reason to suspect that this year's feast of the unleavened bread, kicked off by the Passover, would be different than any other. Each year in the early morning on this day, since time immemorial in Israel, the Kohen Gadol would journey to the next hill south of Jerusalem to a little town called Bethlehem, House of Bread, to select the Passover lamb. While each family would select their own lamb without blemish on the first year, this special lamb would be raised in an exclusive flock by the shepherds of Bethlehem, the town prophesied as the birthplace of the coming Messiah. Strange, seeing as how that town didn't produce much of anything. The Kohen Gadol would choose the most perfect lamb of the best flock, then head back north to the gates of Jerusalem, where his priests, the Kohanim, would be awaiting him in silence. The entire path from the gate all the way up to the Temple Mount, nearly 3/4 of a mile, would be lined on both sides with Kohanim facing each other on opposite sides of the road, freshly cut palm fronds in hand. The people, in preparation of this exciting annual event, had all prepared their own palm fronds, which leaned against houses and sukkah alike. The entire city looked to be a vast forest of greenery, given the swollen population at this time of year, over 100,000 people in fact. You see, there were three feasts a year that Israelite men of age were obligated to attend, and Passover was one of them. Many had already made the journey to Jerusalem in order to be sure to be there in time. They had all cleansed themselves in the mikveh pools at the south of the city, in preparation for the coming of the Messiah, as Moses had instructed. Just in case, all these faithful adherents to the feasts would wait, silently in their homes for the usual signal. Upon spying the Kohen Gadol with the specially selected lamb, the Kohanim would begin to shout, "Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! Hosanna in the highest! Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord!" Here was the signal. Those within earshot of this joyous cry would burst out into the streets, grab their fronds, and run to line up behind the Kohanim, to wave their palms and take up the city. Meanwhile, on this particular year, as the lambs at Bethlehem were being scrutinized by the Kohen Gadol, Yeshua sat among loved ones eastward in Bethany at the home of Lazarus, he who had been recently raised from the dead by his beloved friend. These loving disciples anointed the Son of God with spikenard, not knowing that this was a foreshadowing of his impending death. Ever obedient to attending the feasts, the company soon set out on the road, traveling westward to Jerusalem, toward a group of disciples Yeshua had requested to gather at the gate. As the company approached the city, Yeshua asked two disciples to find a young colt to be his steed, a male donkey that had never carried a man. The Kohen Gadol, content in his choice of sacrificial lamb that morning, set out on the road southwest of Jerusalem. He was sure the lamb would pass the required 4-day inspection up on the Temple Mount by the people in the city. His journey nearly complete, the Kohen Gadol was just about to be spotted by his ever-vigilant priests, looking intently to their right, when suddenly he heard a commotion. A group of disciples of that bothersome Yeshua ben Yosef were ruining everything. Seeing Yeshua approaching the city gates on the opposite side of the Kohen Gadol, those gathered morons began the shout, "Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! Hosanna in the highest! Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord!" To the high priest's horror, the shout was taken up by the Kohanim inside the gate, who had obviously mistaken the disciples' voices for those of the confused priests just outside the walls. As soon as the horrified priests were able to collect themselves, they frantically screamed at Yeshua to force his people to shut up. "Make them shut up!" Yeshua refused and explained that even if he did, the rocks themselves would take up the cry. This very moment, the one Israel had rehearsed for hundreds of years, was now fulfilled. The priests were dumbfounded. What heresy! Such a gross crime qualifies one for the death penalty. Yeshua, followed by an enormous adoring entourage, entered the gate on the back of his donkey and disappeared from view. As the people shouted gleefully, leaving their house of sukkah and taking up their palm fronds, they lined the streets with their countrymen, only to see that amazing Rabbi Yeshua ben Yosef approaching on a donkey. "Yes, this feels right," So many of them instinctively thought as they continued the Hosanna cry. Down below, a befuddled and angry high priest stood in a small crowd of sheepish Kohanim, unable to enter the gate for the crowds. A little lamb stood bleating at his side. About 2,000 years ago, shaken by his experience at the city gate on the morning of Aviv 10, a Friday night at sundown to Saturday at sundown by the pagan calendar, the Kohen Gadol tied up the specially chosen Passover lamb up on the Temple Mount for its required 4-day inspection. He tried to ignore that irksome Yeshua ben Yosef, who was also on the Temple Mount being grilled by Herodians, Pharisees, Karaites, and Sadducees alike. So far, no one could find fault in him, despite the constant attempts to trip him up. This man was obviously guilty of heresy, but his adoring followers were too great in number to ignore. The attempt to arrest Yeshua ben Yosef 6 months before at Succoth, the Feast of Tabernacles, ended in frustration, given Yeshua's ability to mesmerize the temple guard sent to apprehend him. Well, just as the spotless lamb on a leash would die after its inspection, so would this man, no matter the cost. 2 nights later, the entire Sanhedrin met in secret to discuss this problem. They determined that the blasphemous disturber would be arrested, but this time at night, in secret, and with assistance of Rome, who would be impervious to the supposed rabbi's silver tongue. But it had to be soon. No capital punishment was to be carried out during the feasts. Thank heavens Rome allowed conquered kingdoms to run things the way they liked, for the most part. All they needed now was someone close to Yeshua to betray him, perhaps that disillusioned disciple. His own treasurer might be interested in a transaction of personal interest. Aviv 14, a pagan Tuesday at sundown to Wednesday sundown, day of preparation. Beginning at sunset, the people gather for their usual evening repast, anticipating a good night's sleep. Then, too busily, go about preparing unleavened bread, gathering assorted necessities, procuring bitter herbs, and taking a male lamb without blemish of the first year up to the Kohen Gadol for him to slaughter on the Temple Mount. Perhaps the most tedious law concerning Hag Matzot, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, was the requirement that each Hebrew family had to completely rid their house of sukkah or anything leavening. Only a complete and thorough inspection of all pantries and larders would do. Even things that had touched leavening of any kind had to go. For that was the rehearsal Jehovah had commanded through Moses, the prophet, on the eve of the first Passover, Pesach. The 7-day feast of unleavened bread was kicked off by the Pesach. There would be no leavening for the whole week. For this was the week the children of Israel fled Egypt, arriving at the Red Sea on the 7th day. The children of Israel had no time for leaven to rise. They were to bake the bread as quickly as possible for the Pesach, then leave Egypt forever. This year after sundown, Yeshua ben Elohim, Messiah, took advantage of the day of preparation by washing the feet of his chosen disciples. This loving act would not be permitted on a Sabbath or
High Sabbath. So this night was perfect. Pesach would begin in less than 24 hours. This extraordinary time was not only a time of fulfillment, but a time of instituting the new rehearsals, feasts, ordinances. This night at the Last Supper, Yeshua instituted the Feast of the Sacrament, a rehearsal of his soon-to-be broken body with a promise of renewal for him and for any that follow him. At the conclusion of this feast, Yeshua killed 2 birds with 1 stone, with a dipping in wine of the last piece of leavened bread in the home. He offered it to Judas as he dismissed him with an invitation to do what he was going to do. The disciples thought their treasure was leaving to buy supplies for the feast, but Yeshua knew better. Judas quickly scurried out, another fulfillment for the last piece of leaven left, and now cleansed home with the last piece of leaven. Shortly thereafter, Yeshua performed his atonement of mankind in Gethsemane. Almost 1,500 years before, the children of Israel had broken the blood covenant they had made to Jehovah at the base of Mount Sinai, almost as quickly as they had made it. They had been worthy of the death penalty ever since. Animal sacrifices, meticulously observed, staved off the death penalty to the Israelite people for hundreds of years. It was now time for the death penalty to be paid by the only person who had the ability to save Israel, the other party in the blood covenant, the innocent party. By his blood, he would save the individuals on the earth, but also Israel as a nation. Another layer is seen in this event. The very first transgression occurred in a garden, just as the atonement of Jesus Christ occurred in a garden. The original broken covenant between Adam and God was also paid at this time in Gethsemane by the innocent party. Blood as an offering had now officially been fulfilled. The new covenant would require a different sacrifice, the sacrifice of the will of man. The Sanhedrin, true to their plans, had found an accomplice in Judas Iscariot, just in the nick of time. Pesach had yet to begin. If Yeshua slipped from their fingers at this time, they would have to wait until the next mandatory feast, Sukkoth, in the fall. Disappointed that this Messiah came as the suffering servant rather than the conquering hero, Judas decided to appease his extreme frustration by selling the master for 30 silver coins. Judas showed up to Gethsemane with a betraying kiss, signaling to the temple guard that they had found their quarry. As the temple officers themselves looked on, the guard again balked at arresting this extraordinary man. The Roman soldiers sent as backup ensured the arrest was carried through. In the fracas, Malchus, the Kohen Gadol's own servant, had an ear cut off by the firebrand Simon Peter. Simon and his fellows were shocked and outraged by the illegal presence of the temple officers at this arrest. Yeshua, silent about the Romans involved, gave a scathing rebuke to those members of the Sanhedrin present who hadn't the courage to arrest him on the Temple Mount in public. Yeshua ben Elohim, arrested on a Jewish warrant rather than a Roman, had his hands tightly bound, which was not lawful per Jewish customs, unless they feared retaliation. Yeshua gave them no reason to fear this. Even so, his concern was for poor Malchus. Yeshua healed the maimed ear and was then escorted to face a long night of scrutiny. The little Paschal lamb up on the Temple Mount was itself nearly finished being scrutinized. The next afternoon would find both to be innocent lambs for the slaughter. About 2,000 years ago, all through the night of the day of preparation on Aviv 14, Tuesday night on a pagan calendar, Yeshua ben Elohim had suffered through illegal court proceedings, a mock trial. Contrary to their own laws, the Jewish officials had held a trial in the night hours. The former Kohen Gadol, high priest, Annas, was complicit, as was his son-in-law Caiaphas. The current Kohen Gadol, the latter, was considered by the people to be Kohen Gadol in name only. Given that Rome had forcibly stripped Annas of the office for imposing Jewish law without authorization. This night, the two leaders of the Sanhedrin even went so far as to entice men to be false witnesses in the trial, which was in direct violation of the Torah. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. It was poetic justice, then, that no two of these bumbling witnesses could manage to give a similar testimony detailing Yeshua's supposed crimes. Later that morning, in the second and more legitimate session of the trial, Caiaphas restrained himself from pulling his hair out in front of the entire council, attempting to wrap up the proceedings as quickly as possible. There was a rehearsal to see to. Already on shaky political ground with the people, he refused to be responsible for neglecting such an important duty. Although Yeshua, the upstart himself, confessed, of sorts, to claiming to be the son of Elohim, one could not be convicted of a capital offense based solely on his own testimony. Those blasted, blundering witnesses. Soon after the council hastily announced that his crimes were worthy of receiving the death penalty, Yeshua was shunted over to the Roman procurator in charge, Pontius Pilate. Let Yeshua be his problem now. That morning, still a V14, a pagan Wednesday, the Kohen Gadol crossed the bridge from Jerusalem eastward over the Kidron Valley to the Mount of Olives. The Kohen kept his composure as the usual crowds followed him and his priests to witness the next rehearsal for the preparation of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The rabble gathered around the Aviv, ripe, barley fields on the Mount of Olives as the priests 10 cordons. This morning on Aviv 14 was the time to publicly prepare for the upcoming Bikurim, the feast of the offering of the first fruits. This feast would take place on the day immediately following the Shabbat or Sabbath after Pesach. Thus the date was never fixed. This year the weekly Shabbat, Friday night into Saturday night, would be on Aviv 17. That would mean the Bikurim would begin after sundown on Aviv 18, a pagan Saturday night. The priests carefully prepared a 10 omer shocks of barley by wrapping them with the cordons. The future Bikurim, the offering of the first fruits to God, had now been marked out among the rest of the spring harvest. This year, that would mean these 10 special shocks would wait 3.5 days for harvesting. Interesting. As the Hebrew inhabitants and visitors in Jerusalem now scrubbed themselves clean in the mikveh, the baptism cleansing pools, south of the city, they washed, stretched, and dried their garments in preparation for the 7-day Hag Matzot, Feast of Unleavened Bread. The Kohanim did the same on the Temple Mount after carefully inspecting themselves in the enormous brazen lavar sitting just outside the temple. A Kohen was to scrutinize his image in the shining brass, then clean every speck of dust, animal blood, or grime he could find. One was to be completely cleansed of any impurities for the Passover, which would begin at sundown, the beginning of Aviv 15. Satisfied that they were completely ritually cleaned, the temple priest scurried over to where Pilate's seat in his judgment seat at the northern section of the Temple Mount. Unwilling to render themselves unclean by entering a pagan edifice, the eager accusers debated with Pilate outside on the patio. This Roman obviously had no stomach for doing what needed to be done. "I find no fault in him," he shouted in frustration. At the same moment, Caiaphas, obligated by his duties as Kohen Gadol, stood a short distance away. Upon the final inspection of the special lamb from Bethlehem, the Kohen shouted the usual proclamation, "I find no fault in him." In the end, the Sanhedrin had its way. Yeshua ben Yosef was to be publicly executed in the pagan manner, hung on a giant T, which stood for the pagan sun god Tammuz, a fitting end for a blasphemer. On the day of Aviv 14, Yeshua ben Elohim Mashiach, burdened with carrying the very timber of his sacrifice on his own shoulders, walked the very path that Isaac ben Abraham had walked over 2,000 years before. Both men carried their own sacrificial wood to the site Abraham had named Jehovah Yireh, Jehovah Provides. But unlike Isaac, this ram, whose symbolic horns of authority were entwined in thorns, would not be exonerated. Up above, in the opposite direction of Yeshua's path, outside the southern gate of the city, Caiaphas, the Kohen Gadol, stood at the brazen altar covered in innocent blood, slaughtering lamb after lamb after lamb in order to allow the thousands of families to get their Paschal lambs in the ovens before sundown. This was tiring work, despite the unusual dark skies for this time of year. After slaughtering the last of the public's lambs, Caiaphas took hold of the Paschal lamb and performed the sacrifice just before sunset. Directly afterward, he uttered the words of the rehearsal shadow picture, "I thirst." As he wiped his sweaty brow, he was given a sip of water. Down below, at the same time, the lamb said, "I thirst," and was given a sip of vinegar. Immediately after, Caiaphas proclaimed the next part of the rehearsal, "It is finished," as Yeshua filled his aching lungs and proclaimed, "It is finished." Yeshua immediately sank down, having voluntarily given up the ghost. The sacrifice had been made, Jehovah had provided, Jehovah Yahira. And real quick, for those of you who didn't catch that, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, the slaughtered lamb, he had a crown of thorns on his head. And the ram that was provided for Abraham and Isaac was also in thorns. He was tangled in thorns. I love how the Lord planned for all of this symbolism and these patterns before they ever happened. I just love the beauty in that. The skies, already menacing, suddenly crackled with thunder and lightning. A massive earthquake rent the ground, splitting the rocks and soil all throughout the land, leaving huge cracks thereafter. Even many graves of the righteous dead had been cracked, opened in the tumult. These deceased saints in the ancient cemetery on the Mount of Olives were marked as a special selection as they still slept within. The 10 specially selected omer of barley waved in the breeze on the same mount, patiently waiting for the harvest soon to come. Shaken, literally and figuratively, the Romans in charge went about their next duty. It takes about a week for death to find its victim on the dreaded T for Tammuz. Respecting Jewish laws, the Romans went to break the legs of the three convicts in order to allow their loved ones enough time to handle the bodies before the sun went down. This time of E15 would occur at sundown on the pagan Wednesday night. For executions were strictly prohibited during the holy convocations or feasts, the Mikra of Jehovah. After breaking the legs of the criminals on either side of Yeshua with a 65-pound steel bar, the battle-hardened soldiers were aghast to find Yeshua to already be dead. Not really able to believe it, one took a spear and thrust it into Yeshua's side, hitting his spleen. The damage caused by the crucifixion caused both blood and water to gush from that organ. These fluids spilled out and went down a fresh crack in the earth next to the cross. Yeshua's bones remained unbroken, fulfilling yet another prophecy. Yeshua's body was hastily, yet lovingly wrapped and placed in a beautiful borrowed tomb just outside Gethsemane. This heartbreaking task was completed just in time to allow those handling him to be able to mikveh afresh for their Pesach Seder, feast or meal. A thorough preparation for burial would have to wait until the spices could be prepared and a Sabbath, either weekly or special, would not be violated. Just as the massive stone covering Yeshua's lonely tomb rolled shut, Caiaphas, the Kohen Gadol, finished up his meticulous mikveh and sequestered himself alone in a room on the Temple Mount for this year's required 3 days of confinement. No one was to see or speak to him, for he was to remain 100% ritualistically pure until the wave offering. At least this year, it was only to be 3 days. It could be up to double that. Caiaphas sat in solitude, unsure of whether he was relieved or uneasy about the fate of that troublesome Yeshua ben Yosef. About 2,000 years ago, on sundown, Aviv 16, Thursday evening for pagans, Yeshua had been dead for just over 24 hours. The next morning, Friday, on Aviv 16, as the shops opened, the women closest to the master, having left his body unprepared for burial by necessity a day and a half before, busily procured the necessary spices. The distraught women spent the entire rest of the day preparing these spices, for their master deserved a proper burial. The process took many hours, so the women sighed resignedly as the sun went down, beginning the weekly Shabbat, Sabbath, during the 7-day feast of unleavened bread. The resting body of the Messiah would have to wait one more day. The weekly Shabbat on Aviv 17 would be over at sundown, Saturday evening. The priests watched expectantly for the last sliver of the sun to disappear beyond the horizon, some holding implements for the harvest. Caiaphas, the Kohen Gadol, high priest, had only one more night to pass in solitude before he could emerge to perform the wave offering in the temple. The signal given that the sun had gone, beginning Aviv 18, the Kohanim, followed by many Israelites, crossed the bridge from Jerusalem to the Mount of Olives to the east. They easily found the 10 marked Omer, shocks of barley, in the dark, which had been bound ahead of time, 3.5 days before, on the morning of Aviv 14. The crowd looked on as a priest began the rehearsal script. "Has the sun set?" The other Kohanim replied, "Yes, the sun has set." "Will you harvest the barley?" shouted the first priest. "Yes, we will harvest the barley." "With a sickle?" "Yes, with a sickle." As the sickles were raised, the first priest would then ask, "Will you put it in this basket?" "Yes, in this basket." The public then watched as the priests went about harvesting the special 10 omer of ripened barley, white and ready for the harvest. It was late as the reapers and witnesses crossed back over to the Temple Mount with their baskets of ripened barley. The people separated from the priests and went home to bed. One of Yeshua's closest friends, Mary, could hardly sleep during those few night hours before she could finally get to the tomb and care for her master's body. Back on the Temple Mount, the priests began a long night of processing the grain. As they waved it around up on Mount Moriah, the wind blew the useless bits, or chaff, clean off the stalks. The Kohanim would gather the chaff in the morning and burn it. Exhausted, the Kohanim finally put the prepared harvest safely aside to be inspected by the high priests in the morning. In the dark of the early morning hours, still on Aviv 18, Sunday morning for pagans, the day of Bikurim, or Feast of the First Fruits, the first person in the history of man to be resurrected awaited for his friend's arrival. Unbeknownst to Mary, her Lord had no more need of burial preparations. Their greeting, though joyous, was a bit restrained, given the Master's inability to have his purification tarnished by human hands before he presented his Father with the first fruits of their labors. But he knew he would soon return to embrace his cherished loved ones. Soon the city of Jerusalem was awestruck by the arrival of many righteous dead who had crossed the bridge from the Mount of Olives only. These were no longer dead. These resurrected beings spoke to many. They said wondrous things. It was a public witnessing of the reaping of the first fruits. All too soon, the specially chosen saints were called by the Master to gather unto him. Over on the Temple Mount, the Kohen Gadol finally emerged from his sequestration to perform the wave offering of the first fruits. He gathered the stalks of ripened barley and waved them in the temple's holy place, where the menorah and other sacred implements resided, proving to the Almighty that these were pure and free from chaff. As he did so, the Bikurim of the flesh and blood gathered to the true Kohen Gadol and were taken up to heaven by him. He then presented them to his Father in the heavenly throne room, the Bikurim, the offering of the first fruits was now complete. About 3,500 years ago, the children of Israel were gathered at the foot of Mount Sinai. Quaking in fear from the voice booming down at them, no one could mistake the law which was being pronounced. It was the first Shavuot, the 50th day from the Pesach Passover in Egypt, 50th Pentecost in the Greek language, 50th a Jubilee, a day of putting things right, a day of liberation, since the days of Noah. Shavuot was now a day of proclamation. The Torah, or the law instructions, had officially been given from the top of a sacred mount by Jehovah himself. The only convocations, the Mikra, of the spring feasts were now officially instituted, their initiatory phase complete. About 2,000 years ago, Caiaphas, the Kohen Gadol, stepped out of the temple on the day of Yom HaBikurim, Feast of the First Fruits, the wave offering now completed. It was time to begin the official counting of the Omer, as commanded to Moses over 1,000 years prior. Shavuot would occur in exactly 7 Shabbats, or Sabbaths, and 1 day. 7 weeks times 7 days per week equals 49. That extra day makes 50, a Jubilee. The day of Shavuot was literally the Feast of Weeks, taking place in the 3rd month, Sivan. On each of the first 50 days of the spring barley harvest, the Kohanim would offer the grain from a single sheaf or omer of barley to Jehovah at the temple. This processed grain would then be carefully stored with its fellow baskets of grain to be added up until the number 50 had been reached. 7 weeks and a day, Shavuot was a day of gratitude and giving back to Jehovah. None of the grain harvested for these 50 days, either the omer at the temple or those of the masses, could not be baked or eaten until Shavuot, the day of the second offering of the first fruits. Caiaphas and his compatriots finally rested easy. Unlike the earlier feasts that spring, this Shavuot would pass undisturbed by the master disturber, Yeshua ben Yosef. Peace and the ability to go back to the usual order of things had required a high price, but it was one that the temple officials had been willing to make with no regrets. Yes, there were wild whispers that Yeshua had risen, even talked with some, but those fanatical blasphemies would soon die out and decay, right along with their master's body. Caiaphas, the Kohen Gadol, faithfully presented the ripened barley to Jehovah on each of the 50 days between Yom HaBikurim and Shavuot. When finally Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks, arrived, the Kohen priests used the grain of the second offering of the first fruits to make 11 loaves. The Kohanim mindlessly presented the requisite 2 loaves on the altar at the temple. Leavening in the spiritual sense was a symbol for sin. So why was it allowed to touch the sacred altar on this 1 day out of the year? So many centuries of watching and waiting had eventually hardened into an automatic go-through-the-motions attitude that stifled all curiosity of what these rehearsals actually meant. Jehovah had commanded, thus, unquestioning obedience was required. The thirst for the why had spilled out of Israel's soul and been greedily consumed by the desert sands long before. Nearby, the disciples of Yeshua ben Elohim were gathered for the feast in a house of prayer. Suddenly, a pillar of fire and understanding, as it were, burst through their consciousness and poured into their souls, a flaming fountain of the Holy Spirit. The day promised by the Messiah had come. The gift of the Holy Ghost had been unleashed. With that, the apostles, special witnesses of the Messiah, now had access to the gifts or manifestations of the Spirit. As the news of this joyous tumult spread throughout the city to residents and visitors alike, this being one of the 3 required feasts for Israelite men to attend, a vast multitude of the curious surrounded the disciples of the Messiah. These disciples expounded the gospel to the multitude in each language represented. For many gathered there had journeyed a serious distance to obediently attend Shavuot. The Israelites, suffering conquests and despots, had spread quite a distance. Iran, Greece, Elam, Babylon, Turkey, Asia, Egypt, Libya, Rome, Arabia, and even the dreaded island of Crete. Each person heard the good news of Yeshua in his or her own language. As a result of this monumentous fulfillment of the day of Shavuot, 3,000 Israelites became believers in the resurrected Messiah, Yeshua ben Elohim. As they heard of his ministry and deeds expounded in their own tongue, how could they but believe? Recognizing the fulfillment of the deeply familiar spring feasts or rehearsals to the exact detail, these 3,000 new disciples of Yeshua became the second offering of the first fruits on the day of the second offering of the first fruits, Shavuot. These Jewish converts, in turn, were to share the message with the Gentile nations. Now a force of perfectly placed missionaries among their Gentile brethren. Each heathen or pagan nation could now hear the good news of the Messiah in its own language. The prophesied time of the Gentiles had begun at last. The curse of Babel had finally begun to be lifted. The family of Abraham now took their rightful place as the teachers of the true God, as a blessing to all the nations of the world. Though the word hadn't been disseminated as intended, Israel had faithfully kept and preserved the rehearsals, vital to future understanding. I want to pause right here and say that after having read this, this now makes me even more excited to go back to the temple and go through those ordinances and listen to the wording in those ordinances and those covenants, because I'm seeing so many similarities to what I'm reading here. It's just so awesome. But this time, they wouldn't fail. This time, the believers in the Messiah would be sure to share with all those who would hear and not jealously keep his message to themselves as a proud people set apart, only to remain separated from the rest of the family of Adam. Up above on the Temple Mount, two loaves of leavened bread sat in their place on the sacred altar. One represented Israel, the other the Gentiles. These sinful nations were now to be accepted upon repentance through the blood of the Paschal Lamb. Thus, the Pesach sacrifice began the spring rehearsal feasts, and Shavuot wrapped them up. And then she gives a final word to sort of sum this all up. She says, "I've had several close friends ask me, why share your crazy research now? It's an excellent question. This is a subject I've researched extensively for years and years and years. So, why make my neurosis public now? I've purposely waited until finishing the last installment to tell you why. I see a lot of fear out there right now, uncertainty, panic, theories. I sense a collective unease, a holding of breath, bracing ourselves for something intangible. Religious or no, doesn't matter. Just about everyone feels it. I see a desperation for answers, especially one answer to one particular question. What can I expect in the future? Some whisper, are the tribulations upon us? The whole point of my Easter week posts on the spring feasts is to show that we have been told what to expect from the very beginning. All things shall be fulfilled. Let's seek the answers. There is nothing that has happened in the scriptures in the past that won't happen again. Hopefully, those few determined awesome people who made it through all 9 installments have learned how to train your mind in seeing the true meaning behind the spring feasts. What does that have to do with the future? The fall feasts! Okay, guys, there's more coming later this year. Those are shadow pictures of what is to come. Study them. Let's learn them by heart. Learn the dates on the Lord's calendar. Learn these rehearsals and ordinances. Then plug in the revelation as the key code. Jeremiah, Isaiah, and Ezekiel also tell us, even give us exact time durations for many phases of the good, bad, and ugly to come. We don't know the exact day or hour, but we've been told to study the times and seasons. Now, where to begin? I'll give you a list of the fall feasts. You should already recognize a couple of them. I've given you a head start on those. She says, number one, Tishri 1, usually in September. Yom Terah, Feast of Trumpets, Day of Announcements. Remember, this feast was changed to Rosh Hashanah over time. Be careful to avoid learning the current rabbinical Jew reckoning of time. Stick to Karaite or Messianic Judaism for the calendar, for the accurate calendar. Number two, Tishri 10, Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, Day of Atonement for Israel as a nation. Number three, Tishri 15, Sukkot, Feast of Tabernacles, Marriage Supper of the Lamb. And number four, Tishri 22, the last great day, the Feast of Conclusion, the Feast of Leviathan. Also, number five, Kislev 25, Hanukkah, the Feast of Dedications or Lights, a day of cleansing. Number six, and learn about the Feast of Purim, held on Adar 14 through 15. Get to know the story of Esther like we know the story of Harry Potter. Trust me. I want to pause right there because I let my friend know that a couple of weeks ago I was cleaning out some things downstairs and I came across this book. It was sort of a young adult book, like a children's book, maybe early teens. It was the Book of Esther, written for a younger audience. And I grabbed that book and I felt like I was supposed to read it to my kids. Now, I didn't even know we had this book. I've never seen it before. I don't know where it came from. So when I read this from my friend, it was a second witness that we need to read the story of Esther, and we need to read it to our kids. We all need to understand that story and know it inside and out. And then here she provides an image of the calendar of these dates. So there you have it. I just thought this was so awesome. I really couldn't just sum it up and share highlights. I felt like I had to read most of it to you. But again, I have links down below over on my blog where you can see all of this again so that you can take the time to study through it and ponder it out for yourself. But I have to say that after reading all of this and then thinking about the things that have already taken place this year, especially around this Passover, and especially with the Hosanna shout that we just did, it really has my thoughts going. And isn't it interesting that she named her final installment, the ninth installment, the final countdown? I keep seeing those numbers, 1, 2, 3, and 3, 2, 1, and every time I hear them, I hear in my mind, it's the final countdown. The final countdown has begun. And we've talked about that in the past videos. And again, this friend of mine sees the number 14 and 44, just like so many of you do. And she shared with me Joel chapter 1, verse 14. I had seen this scripture circulating around this same week as well. And it says, "Sanctify ye a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God, and cry unto the Lord." Reminds me of the solemn assembly we had at conference and how we also gathered as a world to fast. My friend then pointed out that on her scripture app, this scripture happens to be on page 1133. There's that number, 113. Right around this time, we felt another aftershock here in Utah, and my friend texted me this screenshot. There were those numbers showing up all over this aftershock. Now, my friend lives in Idaho, and around this time, they also had an earthquake over there that they felt. So we've all been getting shaken up and just feeling the need to pay attention.
Well, it was interesting because I reached out to her and I shared with her a dream that I had. And the dream was about her. We were in her home. And in the dream, there were two bats in her home.
And she sent me this text right here that says, "Wow, that's fascinating about the bats. I wished I had gotten a picture now, but this very afternoon I was behind a car with the license plate, bats, today. Wow." Look at the time I happened to see this text from her. It was 11:23, the final countdown. Then it gets even stranger. Another friend of mine who knew nothing about this dream, I hadn't shared it with anyone but my friend in Idaho. My friend here in Utah reached out to me and said, "Did you see this? And it's a news story about a new quarter coming out that has two bats on it. And it's coming out this year." And I said to her, "I just had a dream about another friend, and in the dream there were two small bats the size of a quarter. These bats were tiny. They were like little moths flying around her house. I would say they were the size of a quarter, and there were two of them." So this had my attention. We've also heard a reference to bats just a couple months ago when they first were trying to link bats to the coronavirus as the source of where it came from. I would say there's definitely something very batty going on right now, pun intended.
Okay, now I want to share with you what I heard the Lord say at General Conference. And so, since I truly believe that the Lord speaks through his leaders, through his apostles, and through the speakers at General Conference, I felt it was fitting to read these statements as though they truly are directly coming from the Lord. So instead of focusing on which speaker said what, I'll have all that down at the bottom here. I'll post the names of each of the speakers for what it is I'm reading to you. But I want to read it to you in a manner as though I'm quoting it directly from Jesus Christ himself. It makes it so powerful. Okay, here we go. Here's what I heard. "Fill your personal storehouses with faith, truth, and testimony. Repent daily and receive my cleansing, my healing, and my strengthening power. Seek in every way that you can to hear me. Offer unto me an offering of righteousness. Take your rightful and needful place in your home, in your community, and in the kingdom of God more than you ever have before. Lay aside that which could distract you or delay your progression. Increase your spiritual capacity to receive revelation. Hear me, follow me, trust me, and become an extension of my love. As you willingly acknowledge and carefully treasure the spiritual defining events in your life, more and more of those things will come to you. Helping others understand their true identity and their purpose is one of the greatest gifts that you can give. Give your time and your talents and sacrifice for the gospel, not for any other reason or any other agenda. It is a commandment to take this gospel to all the world. That is the cause that must unite everyone today. As you focus on these principles, relationships, revelation, agency, repentance, and sacrifice, my gospel will sink deeper into your heart. You will see the restoration move forward to its ultimate purpose, the redemption of Israel and the establishment of Zion, where I will reign as King of Kings. The work which has to be accomplished in the last days is one of vast importance and will call into action the energy, skill, talent, and ability of the saints so that it may roll forth with that glory and majesty described by the prophet Daniel and will consequently require the concentration of the saints to accomplish works of such magnitude and grandeur. As you remember me always, you might ask in silent prayer, 'What would you have me do, Lord?' As you pray in faith, you become a vital part of my work as I prepare the world for my second coming. May you find the joy in doing the work that I have invited you to perform. I invite you to be a part of the marvelous coming forth of the Book of Mormon in your own life. I promise you that as you prayerfully and consistently study its words, you can partake of its promises and rich blessings in your life. Your experience will be as glorious and sacred for you as Joseph Smith's experiences were for him. Come unto me so that I can provide you with what you need to get through these last days, trials, and tribulations. As you focus on me, you will see my miracles and feel my peace. You've been given the opportunity to labor with me in inviting others to come unto me. As you labor with me, your most deeply focused efforts should be within your own home. Use my atonement to receive enabling power through which you can put off the natural man, progress line upon line, and increase in holiness. You need my redeeming power to accompany you, to motivate you, and to change you every day. Not feeling motivated? Then you're not taking advantage of my atonement. And I can attest to that. I just want to stop right there and say there were some times during this quarantine period where there were days where I just kept saying, you know, I don't feel motivated. I don't feel motivated to do things that I know I need to be doing right now. I just don't. It might have been that during those times, I wasn't taking advantage of the atonement. I wasn't doing my daily repenting like I normally do, and I could feel that difference. Through the power of the Holy Ghost, I will transform you day after day until the perfect day when you, as I declared, will see my face and know that I am. So again, these are direct quotes from General Conference that I have turned around so that it's the Lord speaking them in first person. Consider the goodness of your Heavenly Father and me, and your trust in us will increase. Your prayers will change because you know God is your Father and you are His child. By acknowledging that every good thing comes from me, you will communicate your faith more effectively to others. Remember each day the greatness of your Heavenly Father and me and what we have done for you. The Book of Mormon provides spiritual nutrition, prescribes a plan of action, and connects you with the Holy Spirit. Written for you, it contains the Word of God in plainness and tells you your identity. Repentance requires you to forgive others and helps you move forward. I have promised to forgive you as often as you repent. This is something that I personally heard. It was a thought that came into my mind. You can forgive people you don't even know. Forgive those who have made mistakes or sinned in the past, things that have happened in church history, etc., etc. By feasting from the Book of Mormon and holding fast to its teachings, you can overcome temptations and receive guidance and protection throughout your life. The Book of Mormon is the Word of God. You will draw near unto me if you study it. If you put in the effort, find those who will support you and repent each day, the resulting blessings will be incredible, and your life will be forever changed as you press forward on the covenant path. Study the lives of the great priesthood holders. Seek to improve yourself daily so you can be ready to meet your Maker. As you pay heed to the ancient prophet who foretold of your day, you will be filled deep in your heart and soul with the spirit and work of the restoration. I promise you that you will see my hand in your life. You will hear my promptings and feel my love. Follow my example and be compassionately aware of those around you. Press forward with love in your heart, walking in the brightness of hope that lights the path of holy anticipation that you all have now been on for 200 years. The future is going to be as miracle-filled and bountifully blessed as the past has been. You have every reason to hope for blessings even greater than those you have already received, because this is the work of the Almighty God. This is the church of continuing revelation. This is the gospel of my unlimited grace and benevolence. Love and serve God and your neighbors, and such selfless service will help you truly hear me and come unto me. You do not come to the temple to hide or escape the evils of the world. Rather, you come to the temple to conquer the world of evil. Invite the power of godliness into your life by receiving priesthood ordinances and making and keeping sacred covenants. You are blessed with strength beyond your own to overcome the temptations and challenges of mortality and to do and become good. The heavenly priesthood will unite with the earthly priesthood to bring about those great purposes. Daily immersion in the Word of God is crucial for spiritual survival, especially in these days of increasing upheaval. Increase your participation in family history, including family history research and indexing. I promise that as you increase your time in the temple and family history work, you will increase and improve your ability to hear me. And I noted to myself that whenever I saw the words all throughout conference, or whenever I heard the words, I invite you to me, that was Jesus talking, because he doesn't force, he invites. To me, that's more than just counsel. It's like a commandment to be blessed. Do whatever it takes to increase your spiritual capacity to receive personal revelation. What will happen as you more intentionally hear, hearken, and heed what I have said and what I am saying right now through my prophets? I promise that you will be blessed with additional power to deal with temptation, struggles, and weakness. I promise miracles in your marriage, family relationships, and daily work. And I promise that your capacity to feel joy will increase, even if turbulence increases in your life. If you know my plan and you have covenanted to participate, you have a clear responsibility to teach these truths and do all that you can to further them for others and in your own circumstances here in this life. Elder Cook mentioned those who have had your names removed from the church, so the modern day Sharams. He says, we need you. And it made me think about how, as I was reading in the Saints, it talked about in church history how many of these people, the Sharams of their day, ended up coming back to the church and ended up becoming some of the greatest missionaries and builders of the kingdom. I believe it would be no different today. Brigham Young was quoted in conferences saying, to accomplish this work, there will have to be not only one temple, but thousands of them. That just tells us that between now and throughout the millennium, temples will continue to be built until there are thousands of them covering the earth. So it was said in conference that just before the Father introduced the Son, Jesus Christ, to the Nephites, the people were involved in a state of fear and to some degree desperation. And I wrote, that is us now. That's what we're experiencing now. A lot of people have felt to some degree fear and desperation. And I heard in my mind, being afraid presses you into me so that you can hear me. This was in my dream that I'm going to talk about in a minute. In my dream, we were afraid. We were uncertain. But at the end of the dream, I felt that if we prayed, that the Lord would guide us to where he needed us to be. I just wanted to share something
from Elder Stevenson.
He said, as I contemplate the next 4 years of the life of this beautiful, noble, exalted, and awe-inspiring Salt Lake Temple, I envision it more as a time of renewal rather than a time of closure. And this is exactly how I've been viewing the church closures, the temple closures, and the whole quarantine situation. He says, the temple will be built in a manner that will endure the millennium. Actively participating in my church and its variety of opportunities will help you to be better prepared for life's changing circumstances, whatever and how serious they may be. As a member of my church, I encourage you to immerse yourself in my word through my prophets, ancient and modern. My attributes are acquired in the process of time by intentional progress along the covenant path. My prosperity is the power to press forward despite the problems of life. As you become like me, you will feel at home in my house, and you will feel at home in your house. You can maintain your home's close connection to my home by qualifying for and using a temple recommend as frequently as circumstances allow. So even if you're not able to use your temple recommend right now, do you have one? Is it current or has it expired? Something to think about. Because he tells us that having a current temple recommend allows your home to connect with his heavenly home. I think that's something we all want right now. We were counseled to study,
the Bicentennial Proclamation to the world that was announced, and to study it privately with our family and our friends, and then to ponder the truths and think about the impact that those truths will have on our life if we listen to them and hearken to them and heed the commandments and the covenants that accompany them.
And I just want to read the last few paragraphs of this proclamation. I absolutely love it. It says, "We declare that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, organized on April 6, 1830, is Christ's New Testament Church restored. This church is anchored in the perfect life of its chief cornerstone, Jesus Christ, and His infinite atonement and literal resurrection. Jesus Christ has once again called apostles and has given them priesthood authority. He invites all of us to come unto Him and His church to receive the Holy Ghost, the ordinances of salvation, and to gain enduring joy. 200 years have now elapsed since this restoration was initiated by God the Father and His beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Millions throughout the world have embraced a knowledge of these prophesied events. We gladly declare that the promised restoration goes forward through continuing revelation. The earth will never again be the same." Keyword right there. "As God will gather together in one all things in Christ. With reverence and gratitude, we as His apostles invite all to know, as we do, that the heavens are open. We affirm that God is making known His will for His beloved sons and daughters. We testify that those who prayerfully study the message of the restoration and act in faith will be blessed to gain their own witness of its divinity and of its purpose to prepare the world for the promised second coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ."
And President Nelson said, "We invite all of God's children throughout all the world to join with us in this great endeavor. Come and see. Even during this challenging time of COVID-19, meet with us online. Meet with our missionaries. Find out for yourself what this church is all about. When this difficult time has passed, meet with us in our homes and in our worship places." And from Elder Uchtdorf, "Come and belong. You will make us stronger, and you will become better, kinder, and happier as well. The Book of Mormon is the property of mankind. It belongs to everyone. Please use this time when the temples are closed to draw upon the power of your temple covenants." So I had recently read the book, The Priesthood Power and Women, and I think I had mentioned this recently in a past video that she talked about in there, that there is something that we receive in the temple. And if we pay attention to those words, it will teach us exactly what we need to know about our role with priesthood power. I was reading it during the closure time of the temples, and I thought, oh, if only I could just go to the temple tomorrow and listen to those words again, because I was trying to remember them, and some of it was there, and then some of it had left my mind. And so I kept just thinking about how great it will be when the temple's open so I can go in and participate in the endowment ordinance and hear that again. Well, that was a couple of weeks ago, and the strangest thing happened last night. I woke up, and as I woke up, I heard in my mind perfectly, word for word, what it is we receive during that temple ordinance, that promise, that gift that is given to us, that power. I heard it word for word. I knew that wasn't coming from me. And I woke up and I thought, oh my gosh, there it is. It was just given to me in my mind as I was waking up. And right when I heard that, all of a sudden I heard the song in my mind, "Put a Little Love in Your Heart." I don't even know when the last time was I ever heard that song, but the lyrics go, "Think of your fellow man, lend him a helping hand, put a little love in your heart. You see, it's getting late, oh please don't hesitate, put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place. And the world will be a better place for you and me. You just wait and see. Another day goes by and still the children cry. Put a little love in your heart. If you want the world to know, we won't let the hatred grow. Put a little love in your heart. And the world will be a better place.
and the world will be a better place for you and me. You just wait and see. Wait and see. Take a good look around, and if you're looking down, put a little love in your heart. I hope when you decide, kindness will be your guide. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place for you and me. You just wait and see. And then it just goes on and on. And it's just so funny that that song was playing. It was like on repeat over and over. I realized it had been playing in my dream, and as I woke up and heard those words spoken to me from the temple, it was playing in the background. And also it was interesting because that's something I had been praying about this week, was to have more love in my heart for others, because I haven't had the opportunity to really go out and serve them in person because of the whole quarantine situation. And I feel like when that happens, when we have less human contact and we're quarantined away in our homes, it can become easier to lose a little bit of that love for others. I feel like I learn to love others even more when I'm in their presence and I'm serving them. So I was praying to get some of that love back. And then that was in my dream. And then when I shared that with my husband, he says, well, that's funny, because when I woke up this morning, I heard the song, "Oh Come All Ye Faithful." He said, it's not even Christmas time. Why would I hear that song? So I thought, well, let's read the words to that song, because clearly there is a whole message here from the Lord. Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, sing choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. The title stands out most to me, Oh Come All Ye Faithful. It's an invitation, and I can hear the Lord saying that to us right now. Oh come, all ye who are faithful.
Okay, and as always, I just have to share the few talks that I put a star by because they really spoke to me. The first one was from John A. McCune, and I'll just sum up what I wrote. Come unto me. Feel his love in our deepest trials. Not every trial will have an outcome that we wish for. God gives miracles. Our youth may question truth. We must love them. We must stay on the path and set the example for them. Separating Christ's teachings from the church is what Satan is doing to deceive and lead people astray. They think they can walk his path in their own way. That's exactly what I was talking about with the modern day Sharons. So to hear this in General Conference was truly a witness of what I have been pondering and sharing in this video. And then in Elder Bednar's talk, I wrote, the part where he's talking about temple work, I looked at my phone the only time during that part of conference, and it was 11:13 a.m. Now that's my pay attention number, and it always reminds me when I see 113 of doing the temple work for our ancestors, doing that family history work. And so he said, right about this part, he said, we need to sanctify our hearts. We don't go to the temple to escape the evil world, but rather to conquer the world of evil. That's why we go to the temple. And then for Elder Cook's talk, he talked a lot about Revelation and the prophet Joseph Smith and living prophets. He said, we need to help families build sanctuaries in homes, temple ordinances and work, and gather on both sides of the veil. He talked about President Nelson's mission. He said, we also need to unite the less active and the people that have no testimony, as well as members who are in apostasy and have left the church. He said, seek, ask, and be patient. And when trying to bless others, revelation comes. So if we're not experiencing enough personal revelation in our lives, let's reevaluate how often we're actually trying to bless other people. What are we doing to be God's hands? And then Elder Gimenez was talking about storms and challenges and suffering, and he said Jesus understands. He said the saints can be happy under every circumstance, so no one has to take away our happiness. No matter what comes our way, we can choose to be in control of that. We can have joy. And then I loved how Elder Christofferson referenced the Book of Mormon and the priesthood ordinances and said that they are for all. They are for everyone in the world. He talked about how as we live as best as we can, our invitations to the gospel will be genuine because we'll be authentic. And then he talked about if someone declines our invitation to learn more about the gospel and they show no interest, that shouldn't stop us from being their friend. And that maybe tomorrow they might be interested. You just never know. So I absolutely loved that. It was a great note to end on. And then, of course, when President Nelson ended General Conference, he ended it with an amazing announcement about 8 new temples. And he said Syracuse, Utah, which is what first caught my attention because that's right where I live. In fact, they're already building a Layton temple, which is where I live. So now I'll have 2 temples probably in equal distance of each other from me. That's just amazing. And then he mentioned some other places. 2 others that stood out to me were Dubai, the United Arab Emirates. That is amazing, having a temple in the Middle East. Wow. And then even more amazing, Shanghai in the People's Republic of China. I just can't even believe how fast all of this is happening. I joked with my husband that maybe at the next general conference they will announce a new temple in North Korea. Just the way things are happening, you just never know. There's been a lot of talk lately about the coming food shortages and famines, especially in the meat industry here in America. And it's crazy what's being reported about that. But as I've been pondering on the coming famine, the plagues, and the pestilence all over the other part of the world where you have all those locusts that are eating all the fields and creating famine over there, it's clear to see that these prophesied times are being fulfilled right now, and it's happening so fast. Now, it's interesting because I had just talked about this in my video today. I talked about how it would be very wise for us to study the book of Exodus because it seems to be paralleling what we're experiencing today. And then I came across this article just now where he says the same thing. This author of this article, David Dodwell, says, "Locusts, pestilence of livestock, disease, the 10 plagues of Egypt seem to be playing out in today's world. As locusts invade Africa, pigs die in China, and COVID-19 stalks the earth." He says it's getting very biblical. And then he goes on to talk about the plagues of Exodus. He says the first plague was water turning into blood. We now see deep red algae blooms in the seas of Hong Kong too often for comfort. Then the plagues number 2 to number 4 were frogs, lice, and flies, with locusts eventually arriving as plague number 8. Today we watch gruesome BBC footage of billions of locusts sweeping across East Africa into Pakistan and India. And now I've talked about this in several of my past video messages. But he says that there's fear that they may invade 60 countries and 20% of the world's land surface. China's foreign ministry is on high alert, where they say locusts already destroy an estimated 10 million hectares of crops every year. Plague number 5 was pestilence of livestock. Today we have hundreds of millions of pigs culled in China, victims of African swine flu, and billions of farmed shrimp succumbing to decapod iridescent virus 1, or DIV1, across 11 Chinese provinces, on top of the almost annual cull of chickens downed by avian flu. And let's throw in the bacteria and fungi cutting a swathe through Europe's olive orchards and the world's Cavendish banana plantations, as well as the collapse of honeybee populations. I was just talking about the honeybees in today's video. Plague number 6 was boils, and here perhaps we should not be too literal. Though given a choice between boils and coronavirus, Ebola, or other recent epidemics, I think the Egyptians got off lightly. Plague number 7 was thunderstorms of hail and fire, and again, I think the Egyptians got off lightly. Compared with the Americans and Australians who have survived recent wildfires, and the millions falling victim every year to typhoons, hurricanes, and other wild weather. In Africa, an economic shutdown may be more deadly than COVID-19. After locusts, the 9th plague feels familiar. Total darkness covered all the land of Egypt for 3 days. No one could see anyone else, and for 3 days no one left his place. That sounds eerily like the lockdowns, which for many are now in their third and fourth weeks. And then he goes on to say that he believes the final plague, which is the death of every firstborn son, he believes it to be a metaphor of what's happening today to the planet. Anyway, it's just another very interesting parallel. Okay, last I'm just going to share some quick screenshots. And this slide right here actually happens to be 3 minutes and 11 seconds long, it says right now. So there's that number 311 again that I'm looking at on a slide where I've circled the number 113. And this was just a screenshot of my last YouTube video. I just happened to see that it had already reached 113 people just on my Happy Lady Facebook page. Pay attention. And then my friend Beth sent this. It says 113,000 people have recovered from coronavirus. Try sharing that instead of the death toll. There again, 113. Pay attention. As I was waiting for the general conference countdown, there was that number, 113. I was just seeing it everywhere, all the time, like I still am, like I always have been. And while we were waiting for general conference, we were checking out the latest tweets on Twitter. The very first one I see when I searched hashtag general conference, there it was, 113. Pay attention. It says, attendance at the first annual general conference, 6. Attendance at the 190th annual general conference, 10. Just a little joke. Then my friend Karen and I were texting back and forth, and she sent me this text right at 11:13. There was that number. And she just pointed out, I've also been seeing a lot of 11:11, which we all have. A lot of 111 and 1111. Just lots of ones. And I've talked about in past videos what that means to me. Here's a hymn that we were singing at our Sunday morning services in our home. We were having home church. And right when we started singing, I looked at the hymn and it was 11:13 a.m. And there's the message, now let us rejoice. Now if you pay attention to the words of this hymn, it is very fitting for what we're going through right now. It's all about the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and everything we can expect right up until that moment. But how instead of having fear, we need to rejoice. And I want to focus on just the last verse. In verse 3, it says, in faith, we'll rely on the arm of Jehovah to guide through these last days of trouble and gloom. And after the scourges and harvest are over, we'll rise with the just when the Savior doth come. Then all that was promised, the saints will be given, and they will be crowned with the angels of heaven. And earth will appear as the Garden of Eden, and Christ and his people will ever be one. I love it. Then someone shared this video with me, Symbolism and Meaning in Joseph Smith's Last Dreams. And the video happens to be 11 minutes and 13 seconds long. Pay attention. And then right there on the front page of my YouTube channel, look at that. Look at all these numbers just on one video. 133. 113, 33, 44, numbers that I see all the time. Pay attention. And it's in relation to New Year's, talking about the new year, the year 2020. Now I have a link to this video down below. I was watching this video clip. It's a Glenn Beck special. And in this, he's talking about Agenda 21 from the past and the new, I think it's called Agenda 2030, something like that. And he talks about the World Health Organization. And anyways, he points out in this plan, it's section 11.3. So there was my pay attention number, 113. It says in their plans, by 2030, enhance inclusive and sustainable urbanization and capacity for participatory, integrated, and sustainable human settlement planning and management in all countries. Just the sound of that. Human management, human settlements, just doesn't sound right. My friend Karen shared this image on her Facebook page of the new logo of the church with Jesus Christ on the front. And right when I saw this, there it was, 44. Pay attention. And then as I was checking out at the grocery store, look at the total of my balance, 144. I just see it all the time, all day long, everywhere I go. And then someone pointed this out to me and sent me a screenshot of this verse in Doctrine and Covenants. I forget what section. Verse 114, it says, "Nevertheless, let the bishop go unto the city of New York, also to the city of Albany, and also to the city of Boston, and warn the people of those cities with the sound of the gospel, with a loud voice, of the desolation and utter abolishment which awaits them if they do reject these things. For if they do reject these things, the hour of their judgment is nigh, and their house shall be left unto them desolate." When you read that scripture, that prophecy, and then you think about what's recently happened in the state of New York, for example, this quote here from Governor Andrew Cuomo, he said, "The number is down because we brought the number down. God did not do that. Faith did not do that. Destiny did not do that. A lot of pain and suffering did that." So he's taking credit for the reason that the number of COVID-19 cases has gone down in his state. This was right after the worldwide fast. We had a worldwide fast called for by President Nelson, and we saw the numbers go down all over the world after this fast. And then Governor Cuomo says, "No, God didn't do that. That wasn't because of anyone's faith. We did that." And he took credit for that. And then what led up to all of this, if we back it up just a year ago in the state of New York, Governor Cuomo passed an abortion bill. Listen to this. He said, "This is the most aggressive women's equality platform in the nation. It's going to be in law in this state." He said, "And that's the way it should be." And according to one news article, it said, "The measure establishes in New York state law the right to choose abortion without restriction up to the 24th week of pregnancy." So 5 months into a woman's pregnancy, for no reason at all, without any restriction, she can just decide to end that baby's life. And after that, if the life or health of the mother is threatened, or the fetus is determined not to be viable, she can still have an abortion. Now, after he signed this bill, they celebrated. It was like a party. You see, he's wearing the pink tie, and the woman behind him is wearing pink. And then he called for a statewide celebration. He directed the One World Trade Center and other landmarks in New York to be lit up in pink to celebrate the signing of the Reproductive Health Act. This is the celebration of the most highest form of evil and wickedness. And then J-Lo, who is from New York, performed at the Super Bowl halftime show this year. And in her performance, she showed a depiction of this happening. She showed the Empire State Building lit up in pink, and then she turned it into a stripper pole and danced on top of it while she's also wearing pink. I believe this celebration at the Super Bowl halftime show is the most blasphemous thing we have ever seen done on TV, ever, period, hands down, as she celebrated this evil and wickedness in the Empire State. And she said that her performance had a theme. It was all about girls and women's rights and empowerment for women. So there you have it. Until New York repents of this wickedness and this blasphemy, they are ripe for destruction. They are on that path of destruction. And we're going to see them continue to get hit hard with destruction until they turn around and repent. The scriptures show us what has happened to every past empire that has not repented and proceeded in wickedness. They have been destroyed. The Roman Empire, the Babylonian Empire, and I believe the Empire State of New York is ripe for destruction. They are on that path. They are part of modern-day Babylon, the modern-day Babylonian Empire. And the scriptures tell us that right before the Lord comes, Babylon will fall. And I had seen lots of people circulating this scripture, Joel chapter 1, especially verses 14 and 15. So here's a screenshot I took, and this one says, "My father-in-law just sent this to all of us, and I had to share because I'm a little blown away. It says, 'Sanctify ye a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God, and cry unto the Lord. Alas for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as destruction from the Almighty shall it come. Wow. So we just gathered as a solemn assembly and we just held a worldwide fast, and there you go. And then I happened to be reading about the history of sacrament cups in the church. It's actually really fascinating. And in there, I read right here that after they decided to get rid of just using one cup for the whole ward, passing around one cup and everyone putting their lips on that same cup, they came up with some different designs for sacrament trays with separate cups. And it says right here, there was one design that could empty and refill 144 cups at once. There was that number. A friend of mine sent my son a birthday present, and he got it on his birthday, and so I texted her how much he enjoyed the present, and I realized I texted it to her right at 1:44 p.m., my pay attention number. 1:44 is a gathering of Israel number. I've talked about it before, and this sweet friend of mine has been very interested in the gospel, and she's been investigating the church, and I'm just really excited for her. And so I just thought, how exciting that I see this number on a text that I sent her to thank her for the sweet gift that she sent my son. I happened to watch a video about the theory of dogs descending from wolves. Anyways, it was just kind of interesting, but there, 144,000 subscribers. I'm telling you, I see this number all the time. And there's the number 44 on an earthquake video. And the final chapter of Saints Volume 2 happens to be chapter 44. Of course it is. And the title of that chapter is Blessed Peace. When I was reading in my book about priesthood and women, this was interesting. I noticed this, and I happened to notice it at 11:31. So there's 113. But there was a footnote on this particular sentence, and it's footnote number 44. And it says, President Nelson praised women who know how to call upon the powers of heaven to protect and strengthen their husbands, their children, and others they love. Wow. And there has been a lot of talk over the last couple of years about when the second part of the Great American Eclipse crosses over and makes an X in the year 2024, it will cross over seven cities named Salem. So as you can see here, this slide says the seven Salems of the Great American Solar Eclipse. And there's been entire presentations done about that. But this is interesting because look right here, I got a voicemail on my phone from Salem, Massachusetts. And look at the time, 1:23, 1:23. It's the final countdown. And then right as I'm editing this part of the video, look, right up at the top there, it's 1:44 p.m. Pay attention. Around the time of the Salem voicemail, I got a tweet show up on my phone, and it says, Vatican Bank under fire, HMCD 123 status. There it is, the Vatican, fire, and the final countdown. Then the other day, as I'm pondering all of this, I look at my phone, and of course, it's 11:23. There it is, the final countdown. And look at the top. My phone happens to be at 44%. And while the Lord is at work building his kingdom, you better believe that Satan's working just as hard. We were at the grocery store the other day at Walmart, and right in front of us on this huge display are these potato chips, Zaps. New Orleans kettle style voodoo. They're voodoo chips. And if you look closely, you'll see little voodoo dolls with needles sticking out of them all over the design of the bag. Who would want this in their home? And even more so, who would want to put this into their body? Speaking of Satan being hard at work and how we need to be careful of not letting him into our homes and into our lives, I want to share an experience that happened with our family the day I saw those voodoo chips at Walmart. So later that night, there's a show on the History Channel that my husband loves called The Secret of Skinwalker Ranch. And it's a documentary about a place in Utah called Skinwalker Ranch. And I think it mostly had his interest because it's here in Utah, and he'd never heard of it before. And it's a location where there's a lot of crazy activity that happens, and it's been studied by many researchers and scientists to try to figure out all the crazy phenomenon that happens
on this land. And there have been a few private owners that have purchased all of this land just so they can study what happens there. But they talk about radiation that comes out of the sky and hits right down on this land, and how there have been crop circles, UFOs, unexplained paranormal activity, shapeshifters, things of that nature happening all the time on this land. And they said it goes way back into the history with the Ute Indian tribes as well as the Navajo, and that the Navajo were very aggressive towards the Utes, and they took Ute Indians as their slaves. And they said because of this, they placed a curse on the Ute Indian nation on that land. Anyways, in just about every episode, there has been a scientist or a researcher who's received some type of a head injury, especially head pain and dizziness. And there was one man in particular who, every time he disturbs the soil on the land, he is sent right away to the ER with a crazy head injury that cannot be explained. It happens every time. So in this episode my husband was watching this week, there was a room in a home on the property. There's lots of different buildings on the property. It's pretty big, but there was a little house somewhere out on the land. They went and knocked on the door, and the family let them in. And they had a room down in the basement that they discovered that was solid concrete with no windows or doors, no way to enter, but someone had sealed off this room with concrete. So they felt that they needed to investigate and see what was in there, what was being concealed, who did it, and why. And when they tore through the concrete, they found a pile of ashes on the ground, something that had been burned. And it was very strange. And I remember when I looked up and saw that on the TV, I thought to myself, well, that sounds like some type of a sacrifice. That sounds like somebody has opened up some kind of a demonic portal in this home. And is this something we want to be watching on our TV in our house right now? Right when I had that thought, and I actually said it out loud to my family, my daughter Cambry fell off a chair in the living room and smacked her forehead on the corner of the coffee table. She was just playing with the dog, and she happened to fly off the chair and hit her forehead on the coffee table, and it split it open pretty deep. It was the size of a quarter. It was really deep. You could see into her head, and blood just started gushing out everywhere. She started screaming. My other kid started screaming and running. There was blood everywhere. Here's a screenshot I took of a post on Facebook that talked about someone reporting seeing these strange lights in the sky. They said that there were lights, there were about 30 of them in a straight line, equally spaced, flying across the sky, and it was crazy. So she posted this link to an article in Forbes about Elon Musk's Starlink satellites, but as I read through all the comments below, they said that what she saw doesn't really fit the description of his Starlink satellites, and so they had all these theories, but lots of people who responded to that said they too have also been seeing a lot of strange phenomena in the night skies, and it reminds me of the prophecies of the last days, how there will be strange signs in the heavens, strange things to see in the skies, just something to pay attention to. So now I'm going to end with my dream. I'm not going to go into detail because I don't think the details matter. I want to give you the gist of the feeling that I got and what I took away from it. Now, just so you know, it's been quite a few months since I've remembered a dream. This woke me up at about 4 a.m. and I woke up in a sweat and I was sort of panting, trying to catch my breath. I felt really hot and I felt like I couldn't go back to sleep. And as I laid there, I felt, you need to write this down. You need to write this down or you might forget it because it's something you need to remember and ponder. So the dream was I was in my home with my family and I had some other extended family members show up. And everyone had been hearing these rumors all over the country that the government was coming into cities all throughout America and that they were taking people's homes and property. And they were either arresting you, killing you, or just kicking you out immediately without even time to pack anything, just sending you out immediately and just sending you off on your way with nowhere to go. And suddenly, all over the news, they were saying, this is a rumor that simply isn't true. Don't listen to it. This isn't happening. It's not going to happen. And we thought, well, that's interesting that they're talking about it on the news. And then just as soon as we heard it on the news, suddenly it just happened right on our street, right in front of us. These
trucks and cars pulled up. They started barricading off the road and they were going door to door. And it's interesting because it reminded me of like a census. They were knocking on the door just saying, oh, we're here to collect information. Please cooperate with us. It's like census information. How many people live here? Do you have anyone visiting right now? And so they were asking a bunch of questions, but one of those questions was your religion, what you believed. And if you believed in Jesus Christ, you were either executed on the spot, taken away, or if they didn't have room for you or time to kill you, you were just kicked out of your home. Either way, they took your home and your property. In my dream, a couple of my family members were killed right in front of us, and the way that they did it was to be very publicly humiliating. So they set up wooden crosses. And they designated a few homes on each street where they set up these giant wooden crosses, and they would nail anyone who believed in Christ to the cross as a way to make a statement to the whole neighborhood, the whole community. If you believe in Jesus Christ, you're gonna die a Christian martyr death. You're gonna die just like he did. And a few of my family members were taken out to those crosses and nailed right in front of me. It was so devastating. And towards the end of my dream, they were overwhelmed with all the people they were trying to round up. And they ended up just telling us, leave your home right now. We're taking your home and your property. Get out right now, leave now, or you're gonna be killed or imprisoned. So we immediately got in the car, drove away. They even took our dog because they had decided that with imprisoning and killing all these people, there would be a lot of homeless pets, and that's a problem they didn't want to have, they didn't want to deal with. So their orders were to execute all family pets, all animals on every property. So they took our little puppy away, and I was so sad. And I remember as we were driving onto the freeway, we were talking about, where are we going to go? Where do we go from here? Because this is happening everywhere. Where do we go? And then I said, you know what? We need to pray right now. And as we pray, the Lord will guide us to a place where he's gathering others who have also been kicked out of their homes and displaced. He'll have a place for us where we can be together and strengthen each other. That's what I hoped for, and that's what I was going to pray and ask. And then I woke up. Now, at the time that I had this dream, I hadn't heard about this House Bill 3009, where it gives a city the right to seize your home or property or put you on house arrest or simply kick you out in the name of a pandemic. I hadn't heard about that. But I remember when I shared this dream with my family, I said, I feel like this is a dream of things to come, that it's a dream preparing for the coming persecution, that it will be very black and white. You're either bold in your testimony of Jesus Christ or you're not. You deny him, and that it won't be easy. The persecution will be hard all over the world. And so I felt it was a dream just saying that that's what's coming. But even though they can take away your material properties and possessions, they can't take away your testimony. They can't take away your place in his kingdom. So that's how I felt. And so just a couple days after I had that dream, people started sending me these videos, you know, the House Bill 3009 and then the New Way Forward Act. And I started seeing, there it is. It's happening right now, right before our eyes. And nobody's seeing this. Nobody's talking about it. But this is exactly what happened in my dream. And it's really being set up for that right now. Again, it drew my thoughts back to the email that the First Presidency sent out, in which they said, this is to prepare you for the more difficult days that lie ahead. And so, having said all of that, I just want to say again, let's not get caught up in all the distractions of the rumors and the fear and the things that we don't have control over. But let's focus on what we do have control over, and that's our faith. If we focus on our faith and our Savior Jesus Christ, he will pull us through these times. We will still find purpose and blessings and miracles during these times. He will use us. He will change us. Let's instead view the coming days and the future as something to look forward to. And that might sound crazy because we know that the coming days are not going to be easy. But if we keep our focus on the final outcome, that's what we can be excited about. That's what's on the horizon. That's what's just around the corner. And that will truly be an amazing time to be alive on the earth. And that will truly be an amazing time to be alive on the earth. With the help of each other and our families, we can get through these times. If we don't lose sight of the Lord, if we don't lose sight of his power, and if we continue to use his atonement every day. I know that to be true. And I've been feeling that right now, that even though this quarantine time has been difficult at times, it's been different. We've had to make a lot of changes in the way that we do things. We've had some adjusting to do. It's given us a time to reflect and readjust, clean some things up, to have that time to pay attention and to hear him. It kind of reminds me of that sentence in that book, A Tale of Two Cities. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. So let's reverse it. Some might see it as the worst of times, but let's choose to see it as the best of times. I know that if we do, we will find peace. We will be happy. We will make it through these times. And I say that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Anyways, thank you so much for joining me today, you guys. I'd love to hear any additional thoughts that you have to share with me. Feel free to reach out to me anytime. I hope you're having a wonderful day, and I will see you next time.